This is Josh Braun. Check, check, check. I want some pizza.
Did you get the welcome to Marshalls?
Cut on, Chad.
Do we want that field mic on still?
It needs to be up here.
All right. You ready, Todd?
Yep.
It's all you, man.
Welcome to the NAIA National Champ.
Welcome to the NAIA National Championship, broadcast live with NAIA TV. Visit NAIA.org or follow us on Twitter at NAIA_news to receive additional information and updates during the event. NAIA, the true student athlete experience. This is the national championship.
Hello everyone and welcome to the 2013 NAIA Men's National Soccer Championship from the Emory Fulmer YMCA Soccer Complex here in Montgomery, Alabama. Well, today it is Auburn Montgomery against Martin Methodist, your finalists. Physical limitations have been pushed. Injuries have been shaken off. Metal has been tested, and here we have our championship contenders. They aren't who were expected, but they are who deserve to be here. Despite their number 11 and number 16 seeds, they have played the hardest, dealt with the most adversity, and earned their championship moment. Now, 90 minutes could be all that stands between Auburn Montgomery and Martin Methodist and a national championship. So stay tuned for kickoff coming up next, brought to you by the NAIA and New Lion, the official video streaming provider of the NAIA.
There's a call to be answered. The spirit of competition is still alive inside. The desire still drives. The phrase student athlete has a great ring to it. Lasting friendships are ready to be made. You just want to keep playing. Game on. Get in the game at playnaia.org.
Tra la la tra la tra la.
Italian family has their own treasured recipes. And now at Carrabba's, we're serving up two family favorites on one plate. Like our wood-grilled sirloin, topped with handmade Marsala sauce and served alongside our signature chicken Brian ravioli. Or enjoy fresh ingredients and layers of flavor, all grilled over a wood fire with our Polo Rosa Maria and chicken involtini. Some of our best recipes are together at last, but only for a short time. So find your favorite tonight and come home to Carrabba's.
I had a dream. Beautiful dream, I couldn't believe how real it seemed. Up on stage, in a field of green, on the winding river, in a song you'll sing. When I wake up, I'll see you, you in Montgomery, where dreams come true.
Yeah, well. welcome back to Auburn Montgomery. Just about set for kickoff, but first we want to throw it down to Josh Braun, who's down on the field, and he's going to bring you an interview with the Auburn Montgomery head coach, Wolf Koch.
Hi there, this is Josh Braun here with Coach Wolf Dieter Koch before the national championships, and we're ready to get going here. Coach Koch, your team has fought back very well during this tournament, all overtime games. If you had any hair, would it have fallen out at this point?
I think that's the reason why I don't have any. I've been doing this way too long. We showed tremendous resiliency all year long, and we had a difficult start to the season at 2-4, and then kind of threw it into gear, and I've been rolling along ever since, and we're excited to be here, and we'll just see what happens.
And do you think that being close to home, obviously you guys are right across the street, do you think that affects your guys at all? Does it give a different edge being so close?
Well, I think it keeps us more into our routine in terms of sleeping in our own beds and following the meal routine and locker room routine. And, I think the guys go to classes while this is going on and not sitting in a hotel for 3 or 4 days and in between games. So I think it helps us a little bit.
Yeah, one last question. Obviously, you had your All-American goalkeeper go down with an injury. You've had Hitpus come in and do very well, and also now Holthus had the red card. He's going to be out. How does your team adjust after that?
I think we got enough depth to substitute for everyone, and we put in Zach Chen Thongfield for Christian today, and he'll do a great job for us.
All right, thanks again, and good luck out there to you today. Again, this is Josh Braun sending it back up to the booth with Todd Panula.
And thanks, Josh, and we want to remind you fans that Turbo Sports Group, the official video production company of this year's national championship. Don't forget, fans, you can purchase a video download of any game from this year's national championship games with video and audio commentary available. Visit TSG online at turbosportsgroup.com. And now quickly before we get to your starting lineups, let's throw it back down to Josh, who's with the Martin Methodist head coach, Jerry Cleary.
Hello there, this is Josh Braun down here again, and now I'm joined by Coach Jerry Cleary, head coach of the Martin Methodist Redhawks. Coach Cleary, you finished this season very strongly, 12-game winning streak now. What has been the key to your team's success here and now in the postseason?
Yeah, we've just been scoring more goals than the other team. That helps you win some games. So, I don't know, it's our strengths are defending. We're defending pretty well, and we seem to be attacking well. So it's a good group of lads that have bonded, and they've connected together, and hopefully we'll keep it going today.
And coming into this tournament, I don't think I knew who Sean Dong was. He's come on very strong as of late. Well, where did he come from? Where did he get this burst of confidence?
Sean's been up and down all season, but at the national tournament, that's why you have tournaments. The best players show, and he shined this tournament. So it's been a credit to him and a credit to his teammates. So.
And you've had two national titles, those being women's titles, but still, you've had experience with this before. Does that come back, and do you kind of know now the routine you get into and how to win a championship from being here before?
I'm not sure that. If it was that easy, everybody would do it. I guess I've just been lucky. My being Irish and being blue-collar, we just work hard, and that's what this team does, and everyone at our school is blue-collar, and we just keep working hard, and hopefully we get the rewards we deserve.
Well, thank you for your time, and good luck. Best of luck to you in the rest of the national championship here at the final game, and we're all hoping you guys do well all as right. Well.
Well, thank you. Bye.
Thanks a lot. And this is, again, Josh Braun. I'll send it back up into the booth with Todd Panula.
And thanks, Job. A great job down there on the field. And once again, fans, we want to remind you that the Select Super Elite is the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Select Sport America is a proud sponsor of the NAIA Men's and Women's National Soccer Coach of the Year and Player of the Year Awards. NAIA member schools are provided the opportunity to participate in the Select Sport Ball Adoption Program where a percentage of all Super Elite sales are donated to the NAIA Champions of Character program. Please contact your local dealer for more information on the finest hand-sewn soccer balls in the world. Select Sport America, the official soccer ball of the NAIA. And once again, we've done it all week. We want to do it once more. We want to thank the Bonefish Grill of Montgomery, Alabama. Bonefish Grill is located at the beautiful Shops of East Chase right here in Montgomery. Bonefish Grill has the best holiday gift available. When you buy $100 in gift cards, receive a $20 bonus card that you can put right in your pocket. For more information, stop by the Montgomery location or visit them online at bonefishgrill.com. Well, Josh, you did a great job down there with the interviews. You got a feel for what their tactics are going to be here. We're going to try to set the table for the fans listening at home, but with all the action that we've seen here in this great week of NAIA soccer, that table is about as big and stuffed full as a Thanksgiving dinner could possibly be.
And it has just been fantastic games all week long. And I'll run through you here all the overtimes we've gotten. I'm just going to double check and make sure they're not doing lineups yet. And we'll get those from the PA announcer when those do come. But again, the first day we were here, we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six of those games were last-minute goals, last-second goals, overtime games. It's absolutely incredible, and we didn't think it could get any better. Last night, it got better. The semifinals were absolutely incredible. Martin Methodist, first of all, ties it up to go into overtime and then penalties with Ashford eventually getting the win. And then the Auburn-Montgomery game, just incredible. Lindsey Wilson. Lindsey Wilson just did not have an answer. They were up 1-0, possessing the whole time, and then just got beat by Auburn-Montgomery, the miracle in Montgomery.
So now we'll send it down to the PA announcer, who's going to have the starting lineups as well as your officials for this afternoon's game.
The scoreboard. At keeper, number 1, Stephen Looney. Number 2, Daniel Dunleavy. Number 7, Felix Christofferson. Number 8, Jonathan Raymond. Number 9, Michael Fulton. Number 10, Sean Dong. Number 12, Nicholas Romero. Number 14, Juan Madrigal. Number 16, Darian Tashira. Number 18, Shane Powell. And number 19, Nick Durbin. Martin Methodist College is coached by Jerry Cleary, and their Champions of Character Award winner is Nick Romero. The honorary coach for Martin Methodist is Roy Loss. And now the starters for the AUM Warhawks. The Warhawks are the 11th seed and the home team on the scoreboard. At keeper, number 0, Philip Hitpass. Number 5, Tim Kaiser. Number 6, Nicholas Hunold. Number 8, Sebastian Vladico. Number 9, Cesar Kestring. Number 11, Elvar Sigurdsson. Number 12, Alan Harwell. Number 15, Zach Chenthongfio. Number 19, Alexander Neubart. Number 21, Yannick Follick. And number 24, Vitor Silva. The Warhawks are coached by Wolf Koch, and their Champions of Character Award winner is Vitor da Silva. The honorary coach for AUM is Nathan McMullen. Please welcome our officials for today's championship match. Our referee is Soren Stosha. Assistant referees are Kalaf Alatefa and Ioannis Stavridis. And our fourth, fifth, and sixth officials are Chad Williams, Jew Carr, and Keith Angel. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please join me in a moment of silence for a true man of character and activist, Nelson Mandela. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we invite you to please rise and join us as we honor America with the singing of our national anthem, performed by Rick Plaskett.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
And welcome back into the broadcast booth as the teams prepare themselves, make final mental checks, get everything in order as much as they can, try to smooth out those nerves as they have a chance at a national championship here today. And Josh, these two teams, no strangers to overtime soccer. They've played plenty of extra time, and it's taken them a rather serendipitous route to get here. But nevertheless, these are probably two of the more deserving teams, as I said in our opener, not necessarily, quote-unquote, the most talented overall, but obviously the most deserving in terms of how they've played so far to get to this point.
They're just both very talented teams, and yes, they have worked hard to get to this point. And speaking of those overtime games, these two teams have played an overtime game earlier in the year during the regular season, double overtime, tied 1-1, and Alan Harwell, number 12, who will be out on the wing, scores a goal with, guess how many seconds left? 1.2 seconds left, and wins it in a golden goal. And that was, again, 1.2 seconds left in overtime. It's just absolutely incredible. And we've seen so many overtime games for both of these teams. Auburn-Montgomery, every single one of their games in this national championship has gone into overtime, so they're no stranger to it.
So the Warhawks making a little bit of a habit here of scoring in the dying seconds as they did last night with only 1 second left up on the clock. We don't have officially point anything. That was basically all that was left up on this scoreboard. But scoring late and finishing it off, and I said it during the broadcast last night with Matt, they just find a way to win. And on the flip side, Martin Methodist, no slouch themselves. As we mentioned a few times, these aren't necessarily seeding-wise, the teams that you thought were going to be here. Number 11 seed in Auburn-Montgomery, the 16 seed in Martin Methodist, and they ended up knocking off the number 1 seed in the opening round and then just charged through since then.
And there are just so many storylines about this national championship that we could run through. I mean, all the overtime games, all the close games, the goals at the end of the games coming out of nowhere. But the key players you got to look at for both these teams are also important. And one of the key players not on the field, in Christian Holtis, he played that attacking midfield role, and he played it very well. He'll be replaced by number 15, Cheng Thong Fio, who hasn't seen much time in this tournament. He's come on sporadically, but we'll see how he does today.
And you interviewed Coach Koch, and he spoke to the depth of his team, and playing now is Cheng Thong Fio. But all the storylines will play out as they were, and we will get to as many as we can throughout this broadcast. But right now, we are at live action as Auburn-Montgomery opened up with possession, but quickly stealing it back is Martin Methodist. Quick onto the attack as they look for the big Scotsman, Fulton. Raymond, that left-footed drive, he's got Dong streaking in. Hit pass quickly to come out and grab it.
That's another story in this tournament. The goalkeeper hit pass obviously hasn't started many games for this team. He's come on for penalties, though, in penalty shootouts in the first two games. of the national championship, and he replaces Victor Johannesson, who is an All-American from last year. Just absolutely incredible.
Here they look for Fulton. He'll get into the box. Right-footed shot. Right save with the boot. Fulton back on the attack. Chips it into the six-yard box. Calmly knocked away after the dangerous attack from the Red Hawks. The Red Hawks versus the Warhawks.
And that's got to be broadcaster's premonition. As soon as we start talking about the freshman who's back in goal there, he gets his boot on it. That was an incredible save.
The goalkeeper's nerves perhaps a bit edgy to start the contest, but he has gotten himself into the game very quickly, making an excellent right foot save. That would be the envy of any hockey goaltender. Now Dong has it knocked away off the boot of Norbarth. But instead it was a Warhawk throw as the teams parry back and forth high up into the air. Raymond tries to settle it down in the midfield, looking for Fulton. They've played the long ball very well here in the early going. Fulton on the right foot drops it, looking for Raymond. He couldn't quite get it down, and it's to the speedy Harwell.
And you see the Redhawks here looking for Fulton early on those long balls. And Fulton had that awesome goal that we saw to tie things up yesterday. And he's also got two goals and assists in this national championship. He's just been an absolute stud. And he's 6'4", so they can find him pretty easily up there.
The big man from Scotland scored to tie it up. However, we would be remiss if we did not mention Durbin at the back about 30 seconds prior to that tying goal. He was able to sweep one off the goal line. This one high up in the air, hit pass, fumbles it. That will go out for a corner kick.
Yeah, and there you see the uncertainty, as I think it's going to be called back for offside now. But you see the uncertainty of hit pass. He is just a freshman. He's shown a lot of confidence in this national championship, but he is only a freshman. He wasn't sure whether to come out for that, did at the last second. And we've seen a lot of goalkeepers drop it through their hands.
And a good eye by you. That was indeed offsides, as it'll be driven away by the right foot of the All-Academic Player of the Year. Or no, that's for Martin Methodist here on the left. That was hit pass that will drive it away. But definitely want to mention that the goalkeeper for Martin Methodist, Lunny, was the All-American Academic Player of the Year.
Yeah, 3.95 GPA, and that's a lot better than mine was when I was in school, that's for sure.
It was around what I had in high school, and then I got to college, and it took a little dip as this one blasted away from the Martin Methodist defense. Dong can't corral it. Silva goes to ground, regains. Back to Vladko. The Auburn Montgomery fans protest, but the foul will go against their team.
That was Silva going down in the middle of the park. We've seen him a lot during this tournament. He's kind of that defensive linchpin for the Warhawks, and we've seen him get tackled from behind a lot sometimes after the play. That kind of comes with playing those balls and being confident enough to hold on to it, so we'll see how he holds up in this one.
Raymond prepares the ball for the free kick. The wind coming from the north today. It's cooled off considerably as this one comes across the goal. Oh, just wide. Dong was there on the doorstep. How he does not put that home is unbelievable.
Yeah, and that was Dong with the flick towards the goal. And then you see the center back, Powell. He was there, and I don't know how you missed that. It was right in front of him. It's just like he got caught up in the moment there and couldn't slot it home. It just needed a touch at the end.
Dong, one of the best finishers for the Red Hawks, does not do so there. Is this one driven up the line? But we'll get a stoppage in play. Free kick to be taken by Norbarth. Or they're going to actually say that it went out for a throw.
I think everybody a little confused there. Jerry Cleary kind of raising his arms on that one, not sure what was going on.
The Red Hawks have had the better of the attack so far as we are in the sixth minute. Good offensive pressure there from Kestring, only to see it knocked out of bounds. Dunleavy, so stout at the back, capable of making runs, takes the throw.
And a dangerous play there to Shara, who just got his legs on it and was down on the ground, so trying to hop around and get something going, but that's an easy call for the referee, Soren Stosha.
Dong making sure his teammates were in position before he allows Norbarth to take this kick.
And not too much height in the box here for the Warhawks. Neither one of the center backs coming forward.
Driven far side, and as you said, not enough height from the Warhawks to get anything on that. They do gain the throw. They find the boot of Harwell. Crossed in. They were looking for Sigurdsson. Parried away. Silva. Intercepted by Ramon. That left foot of his betrayed him just a little bit. The wind has flipped sides from the last few days. I believe this is actually the first time we've seen it blow left to right. And again, bringing up the temperature, it's a good 30 degrees cooler than what we had yesterday. Our producer Scott said that it was 83, a record for this time of year. And I believe it's barely pushing the 50-degree mark here this afternoon.
Yeah, a lot colder, and the Warhawks all wearing short sleeves. Can't say I agree with some of those players. Not wearing anything underneath. I would be freezing out there.
Interesting, especially that they're used to playing down here in the south where it's a bit warmer. You would think the cold might affect them more, but plenty of Icelandic players and Northern Hemisphere players for them as well, so perhaps they're more used to it.
Yeah, Sigurdsson probably used to playing in the cold. It doesn't bother him at all. And it hasn't bothered him in this tournament. He's been playing in the heat, but he has been the hot player for this Warhawks team.
Now the boot came from the academic player of the year, Lunny, as he took that left foot. That one was eventually blasted out of bounds. But Lunny has been shown confidence from his head coach. Not only did he stop the penalty kick to help them put through, he put home the final penalty kick to put Martin Methodist into this championship.
Man, that was absolutely crazy. And I've seen one of the keepers I used to play in high school with take some PKs and be confident enough to do that. But I didn't expect to see it. And Dong hadn't taken a PK yet, so I expected him to be the fifth PK taker. And then up steps Lunny, and it was a beautiful penalty. Can't fault the guy at all.
Well taken by the goalkeeper for the Redhawks. But as you said, very strange not to see their leading attacker take one of those penalties. As this one goes into touch, and Dunleavy will take the throw.
And Dunleavy, one of those SSAC all-conference players.
Dong dispossessed. Here comes Sigurdsson. Slide tackle avoided, but the ball evaded Sigurdsson. Once again into touch. Dunleavy, the wing back, looking for Teixeira. He struggles to get around Chingthongvio. Dong, far side for Ramon. Takes a couple dribbles and then puts it across the face of the area. Easily cleared away by Vladko. Ramon. Long ball looking for Fulton. He's muscled away by Hunold. Hit pass. Looks up the wing. They retreat a few steps. That one almost taken by Romero in the midfield.
And the Warhawks haven't really gotten anything going forward yet. You've seen all the chances here for the Redhawks. Obviously the early one with the foot save from hit pass. But Warhawks just trying to get it forward. And we've seen them. They can break so quickly. But so far, Martin Methodist really controlling play.
That one is headed away by Neubarth. Kaiser has it go out of play. It'll be a Redhawk throw.
Again, you see the high pressure. They know that once the Warhawks get it in their defensive third, trying to possess, that's when Martin Methodist springs everybody forward and just tries to trap them in the corner and win the ball back, and they do again here.
As the left-footed cross almost came in, it was blocked out of play, and you begin to wonder, will the loss of Holthus, will it change up their midfield strategy? He was good at holding the ball, distributing. are they going to have difficulty now trying to get it out?
Yeah, and definitely going forward as well. He's the attacker who would find those little spaces, get it. Then if nothing's on, he'll drop it back. But he can also beat a guy with the dribble and then find someone forward. He was one of the best players at doing that. One of my favorite players to watch during this championship, but it could definitely affect them.
12th minute now, still scoreless. As the ball goes out, it will be a corner kick.
And they have two very good corner kick takers as well. Christofferson will take it from this side. It's his right foot, so he'll take those. And then Raymond is on the other side. It's a double-edged sword, man. They can swing him in all day.
Swung in towards goal. Hit pass came out, put a punch to it. Didn't get enough to clear it away, but it fell right to his feet, and the goalkeeper pounces on it. As Auburn Montgomery looks to work it out, a deflection falls for the Redhawks. They looked for Dong. It was there. Nicely cut out. Then the shot from midfield goes sailing over the net.
But again, you see the immediate pressure. As soon as Hitpass got that, got it out to an outside back, Sean Dong all over him. And that was more of an individual effort by Dong, as you see the replay here. Hitpass. Oh, very, very fortunate there that that one came through and he was able to get back onto it. There's a lot of traffic in that box on corner kicks.
Looked like there was some miscommunication between Hitpass and Sigurdsson as he was actually going for a head ball as well. Sigurdsson gets a piece of it. And then Norbarth plays it off the skull of Dong. Dong flicks it up in the air. Continued forward by Sigurdsson as both teams parry it back and forth off their head. Far side for Kaiser. Harwell looking for space. Carries towards the corner. Slows up. Speeds up. Now taken away. And the foul will actually go against Harwell.
And that'll be an interesting matchup to see on the outside there, the right side, far side of the field. That's Harwell and then Madrigal on defense against him. And Madrigal, one of the best outside backs in this national championship, also an SSAC first team player. And he's just, he gets forward too into the attack. I don't know how he does it. He can run all day, and he's going to have some pace to keep up with Harwell on that wing.
Harwell a bit taller than Madrigal, but Madrigal able to bounce him speed. Now here comes Dong from the right wing. A nice little move around the defender. Puts it to the right foot. Shoots. He scores! Sean Dong, and it's 1-0.
And, I mean, what else can you say about this guy? He has been on fire all championship long, and that is an incredible touch around the defender, and then a perfect slot. Hit pass kind of left out to dry there as he... Watch this again. Watch this piece of skill. Pass the defender. Vladiko just caught flat-footed. And then from that angle, I think Hitpass could have done a little better as you see that replay there again. I mean, a very tight angle to slot that in, and you got to figure he's going to go back post. But a great shot by Dong to keep it on the ground and just slide it in there.
And again, you wonder about the use of Hitpass. We haven't seen it come into play, but perhaps a little bit right there, as he seemed indecisive as to whether he wanted to challenge that shot or stay back, and got caught, tried to make the foot save. It was not there.
And Dong, 5 goals now in this national championship. I mean, just absolutely on fire. The guy has been incredible. Player of the tournament for me so far, if his form holds up for the rest of this game.
So the goal comes from Sean Dong, and would you expect anyone else for Martin Methodist? This one swung in, hit pass, able to deny. Another cross from Dunleavy. That one will go out of play. But again, the Redhawks pressuring, seeking, looking for a second goal. And Auburn Montgomery, they have found a way to come back each time in this tournament. But you have to wonder, will they go down 2-0, and can they come back from that much?
I mean, they are just all over the Warhawks. It's incredible to see this high pressure. Every time they try and get it forward, the Warhawks have just been snuffed by this very aggressive Redhawks side. Oh, and a good touch here by Raymond.
We have now played 15 minutes here in this contest. Norbarth from the near wing. Cheng Dongfio back to Norbarth. Too strong for Kestring.
Yeah, and I don't know if we'll get to see that replay again on the goal from Sean Dong, but hit past his position just has to be better on that one. I know he's inexperienced, hasn't gotten a lot of opportunities in games, but you saw him come out, and he had pretty much lined up on the front post from, and you got to be in the goal. He was coming almost out of the goal, allowing Sean Dong that entire back post to go to. As a goalkeeper, you're told to mark up that front post, but just a lot of room back there for Sean Dong to slot it in.
Too high for Teixeira. And as you bring up that point, you have to wonder if hit pass has begun to become too reliant on his height. A very tall goalkeeper. He's well over 6 foot, but perhaps too reliant on it there, feeling he could cover that back post. The throw in for the Red Hawks. Finds no one but the defender. Now they look for Kestring as he takes a spill. The Red Hawks are back on it. Raymond drops it for Madrigal. He'll send one into the box. Flicked on by Romero, but right into the grasp of hit pass.
Yeah, now you see another element of why this Red Hawks team is so dangerous. Both of their outside backs can play beautiful long balls diagonally across the field. And when you're a defender and you've got to switch over to one side to make sure that side's more covered up, they have that ball on the side of the field, it's very dangerous to open up a defense like that. And both these outside backs just brilliant in playing those balls into the diagonal channels.
Auburn Montgomery content to play it through the back. Now a long probing ball was looking for Kestring, and he took a spill on the wet turf. And this ball will go down towards the end line, but as we talk about the ball, we want to thank Select Sport America. Select is both a broadcast sponsor of this year's national championships and also the official soccer ball of NAIA soccer. This one booted up the field. Silva, his pass was cut off. Dunleavy looking for Fulton. He will take it in the box. Right-footed shot just wide.
Oh, man, and hit pass with a huge save there. But again, did you see the positioning? He was all the way out in front of his front post. And again, you want to be covering that front post a little bit, but not leaning too far. And look how far he has to stretch. That's a brilliant save. But again, the positioning by hit pass at first, maybe leaving a little bit to be desired.
And I agree with you. It looked like it deflected off those fingertips, but the official will say that it is a goal kick.
I mean, but look at the extension. That was incredible by hit pass.
Good coverage there from the tall goalkeeper, but again, something I mentioned earlier, is he relying too much on the length, his wingspan, being very tall?
And I mean, where he started when Fulton first got it, that's where the positioning was questionable. He was just almost out on the six, maybe the corner of the six, and then Fulton took a touch in and he got back a little bit into better position, but that's how the first goal happened. Sean Dong just had too much space to shoot towards.
The Warhawks have it in midfield. Silva will play it to the back line. Hunold looking for options. Just drops it even further.
Yeah, and you're seeing, again, the absence of Holtus out on the field. Sigurdsson now dropping back into center midfield, but there's, you know, you get Silva who will drop back and get it from your center backs, but who's going to get it from him?
Now Kestring, a neat little flick. He was looking for Cheng Tongfio. Stepped on, still loose in the box, and that's an easy call for the official.
Yeah, and that's good hustle there by Cheng Tongfio, but you got to be careful. It's your first time starting here in the national championship, and you can't throw in a tackle like that and pick up a yellow card because later in the game could come back to bite your team.
We are in the 20th minute, 1-0 the score on a goal from Sean Dong.
Sean Dong, my man, we've talked about him so much during this national championship because he's been the man in form for this Martin Methodist team, and the Red Hawks themselves have just been so good. In the 12-game winning streak, I mean, that's just incredible.
And you begin to wonder, as you saw Lunny take a spill after taking that kick, Will the field conditions play in? We've seen the grounds crew has done a great job here to keep these fields as dry as possible, but we did get a heavy downpour last night. A lot of players losing their footing. You wonder if perhaps at halftime, if they have any available, if they'll put on the long spikes, or whether or not any kind of slippage is going to cause any mistake, and we've seen plenty of those as well.
Yeah, we'll see if anybody has those metal studs available, and I don't know if anyone's elected to use those today, but today would be the day to wear them.
Raymond plays it towards the box. It goes in, but all for naught, as the referee signals there was a foul inside the area.
That was a beautiful ball by Raymond. That was perfectly weighted. That's exactly where you want it. And in the end, the attacker didn't have to do that much to put it in. It was pretty much going in by itself. Oh, that's just wonderful. And he's got four assists in this national championship. He is a fantastic player.
Silva took the goal kick and then looks far side for Vladiko. He will chip it up the field. Sigurdsson, he almost had a nice little settle, but Dunleavy, he sent a long ball intended for Fulton, but well too long.
And there you see the freedom of the outside backs. Just ping that long ball up and see what happens. With a guy like Fulton up there, he can hold people off, and he's got a good ability to beat people one-on-one for such a big man. You never know what could happen.
Kestring to Harwell and back. He'll chip it across goal, but Lunny right there, and he claims it as his own.
Lunny's just been an absolute stud during this national championship, and we saw his last game. I mean, so many big saves to keep him in it. Without him, you can say this Red Hawks team would have lost that last game.
Headed into the air by Romero. Now Harwell for the Warhawks plays it off a defender. And again, Kestring back to Kaiser. Kaiser sends one through Silva. Near side for Neubarth. To Sigurdsson. Back towards the top of the area. Spinning is Neubarth all the way up from the left back position. This one will go into touch.
That's a lot better from the Warhawks. Finally settling things down and playing those triangle passes, just little passes and moves. And now you see a new substitute. I don't think we've seen this guy all national championship, have we?
The name definitely doesn't seem familiar. Philip Zillis checking in for the Warhawks.
And he comes on for Chang Thong Fio, so they're now to their backup center midfielder.
And the fans once again protest that the call did not go their way. However, it will be with the Red Hawks.
And just interesting to see the dynamics in this one. Martin Methodist getting the momentum, and we've talked so much about momentum in this national championship, and both teams got to be riding high after their finishes. But the Warhawks just looking a little lackadaisical to start off. I mean, the first goal by Dong, he just flat-footed two defenders. Great turn there by Sigurdsson. But momentum definitely with the Red Hawks in this one so far.
You have to wonder if the Warhawks, such an emotional victory last night, did that take too much out of them? Neubarth was looking for the left wing, instead claimed by the defense. Silva will take it back, but has it pilfered by Fulton. Now Dunleavy. Controlled by Dong. Muscled off the ball. Gets it back. And a foul goes against the Warhawks.
Man, and again you see the direct play up to him, though. A great long ball by Dunleavy right on his foot. And they're not looking to play chest or head. You know, they're not looking to flick anything on. What they're looking to do is play that long ball for more possession and more attack going forward. They get it to Dong's foot, brings it down. He's so good with his close control that he can bring it down off that first touch and then give you something in the attacking third. So really great strategy so far here for the Red Hawks.
A dangerous kick coming forth from Raymond. He's got one of the strongest left foots we've seen. He'll try his luck at goal, but that one a bit too strong.
Yeah, and we've used the word optimistic to describe some of these shots from long range in this national championship, and that one was definitely optimistic by Raymond, but when you've got a left foot like he does, And if I was Jerry Cleary, I would give him license to shoot from there all day. I mean, he's got a cannon.
Remember, fans, join the 60,000 student-athletes who participate in sports at the NAIA, where there are 23 national championships and student-athletes earn more than $450 million in scholarships each year. Learn more about opportunities to play in the NAIA at NAIA.org. That one knotted away from the defense. Taken by Dong. He's got a man left. But he decided not to take it. Chose to control the ball. And now given right back to the Redhawks. Looking for Dong again. Romero a little upset that Dong didn't continue a run. But the Warhawks now have possession.
And you see that little move by Dong. That was the same one he used to get the goal. He beat Vladiko with it, and that it's just that little quick touch from right to left foot, and you see Lionel Messi do it a lot. It's not an extravagant move. It's not for flair, but it's very, very effective, especially when you're quick and have close control like he does.
Now the Warhawks will play it out from the defensive line. Kestring, again, his footing just betraying him. He can't seem to stay upright.
Yeah, and Kestring hasn't found his footing literally and figuratively for this Warhawks team so far. He hasn't brought a lot down and helped them in the attacking third from those long balls yet.
As the Redhawks claim it in the defensive line, now Harwell with a bit of a shove to the back of Ramon. The referee allows it to continue. Players collide on the far side. The Warhawks claim it, given away in midfield. Romero looking for Fulton, stepped into nicely by Hunold. And that's Zillis over there. It had possession pilfered away, but gains the throw. As it looks like we might be getting another fresh body for the Warhawks. Now possession regained by the Warhawks in midfield. Silva has it taken away, and now numbers push forth for the Redhawks. A slicing challenge there.
That's going to be yellow. Yeah, Teixeira, great move to beat Vladiko. And Vladiko, the big man, we've called him the doctor during this tournament, and he might want to take a look at Teixeira. That was a hard, hard tackle, and Teixeira is staying down.
So the yellow card given to Vladiko. And once he missed the ball, you knew that that was going to be a yellow card all day.
Yeah, Teixeira, beautiful touch to get around. And that one was also springing an attack for the Redhawks as well. So that's got to be an automatic yellow, especially when you come in on a slide like that. The guy beats you cleanly. And Vladiko knew what he was doing. He was going to get the ball, or he was going to get the man. And it's not a bad foul if you're the coach, Coach Dieter Koch down there on the sideline. I mean, you stopped a dangerous counterattack. It's scary to see Teixeira down on the field now.
And you have to wonder the extent of the injury, as it looked like an extra trainer had been called towards the field, but good to see Teixeira back up on his feet, and he will head over to the sideline on his own power. Not that it matters too much overall, since there won't be any games following this one, but that is the sixth caution of the year for Vladiko.
Yeah, Teixeira, an important player for this Martin Methodist team, and though the stats don't speak to it, he's only got 2 goals and 2 assists on the season. He's a very effective player at playing those short passes and keeping possession for this side.
Now Kestring has actually come off for the Warhawks. Not sure if they were allowed their substitute, and they were indeed. It'll be Eyolfsson coming on into an attacking role for Auburn Montgomery.
And Eyolfsson has that big body. He's able to bring balls down. They'll be looking to play direct to him and get something started from there.
Judging by the flags, the wind has calmed down quite a bit from what it was earlier this morning. Dong, the right-footed cross. It goes all the way across. Fulton caught a piece of it, but he did not expect that ball to get through so many bodies.
And Dong has just been absolutely incredible, especially today. I mean, every touch he's made seemed like he's created an attacking opportunity, a shot on goal. The guy just looks brilliant today.
And Dong took a bit of a knock from Neubarth. You have to wonder if that might end up being a strategy for the Warhawks to try to rough him up a little bit as he takes a bit of a hip check there. And Coach Cleary unhappy that no call came forth, but that, although it would be a foul perhaps in midfield, once it's in the box, you're rarely going to see something like that given as a penalty kick.
That's a very, very smart play by Neubarth. He knew what he was doing, and Dong had found that yard of space. Neubarth put in the shoulder into his back and knocked Dong off his run, and that one was looking dangerous. He could have gotten another head on that one.
Now Sigurdsson leaves it for Follick. Haven't called his name too much this afternoon.
That's a really disappointing ball from Falick. He had Harwell on the opposite wing, but too much in-swing on that one goes straight to the keeper. And again, they haven't found their attacking players enough in this game. Sigurdsson, Harwell, and now Eolfason up top. I mean, they just haven't got enough quality touches in the attacking third.
Fulton penalized for the hold there. That will allow Hunold to send one upfield. As this one is whistled for another foul. And once again, we want to thank the Bonefish Grill, a broadcast partner of this year's event. At Bonefish Grill, enjoy their signature appetizer, Bang Bang Shrimp, tossed in a creamy Asian-inspired sauce with a kick. Bonefish Grill, located at the Shops at East Chase, right here in Montgomery. This one towards the area. Fulton gets a flick onto it. He had Romero there, but it was just too far. Madrigal chasing it down, throws a shoulder into Harwell, who did the same. The Warhawks come away with it.
Now a little switch in the center of midfield. You see Sigurdsson now is going to play that attacking midfield role, and now Follick actually moves out to the left wing. We haven't seen him out there all championship long. But interesting, they're trying to get Sigurdsson more involved, obviously, because he's their man.
Approaching the 32nd minute here. It looks like it has been all Red Hawks so far this half. Very few chances on goal. No official shots on goal for Auburn Montgomery. But they are specialists at coming back late.
We've seen that so far. Again, I mentioned it in the interview with Coach Koch. Every game they have played has gone into overtime. It's incredible. It really is. And they've won everyone. They've won and they've come from behind in some, and the game against Lindsey Wilson last night. I mean, Lindsey Wilson, incredible team, quality, possessed the entire game, and then Warhawks again found a way to win. Wow, that was a hard tackle by Eolfason.
But he got all ball, and then Romero collided with the ball, injuring himself. Now Harwell comes in from the wing, looking for Sigurdsson, right-footed drive, and that's gotten in front of by Durbin.
And that's so much better. And it all starts with the breaking up of play by that big man up top, Eolfason. What a crunching tackle. And as you said, all ball. That's a great way to get started on the counterattack. And now it gives this crowd a little life, too, as you hear them chanting.
Follick was looking for Zillis. Instead, it's Christofferson for the Redhawks. Through midfield, Raymond Dunleavy. He's got Dong streaking up the wing. He'll send a ball for him. He will run onto it. Dong, seeking options, plays it across. That one nicely played from the back end, kept in play, and then blasted out. Now the long ball looking for Monhay. He checked in without us noticing. Little sneaky there.
Monhay will play on that left wing, and he just gives another attacking option. And Raymond will actually drop back into the center of midfield as well, so both teams deploying what were usually wing players into the center of midfield. And another attacking option coming off the bench. Monhay just very effective up there as well.
Monhay coming in for Teixeira. A much more attacking lineup now for Martin, despite the fact that they already have the goal. Less than 12 minutes left to go in the half. 1-0 is your score. Sean Dong, the goal scorer.
And I mentioned that quality off the bench. Monhe, 5 goals and 9 assists this year. He's tied for the lead in assists with the Frenchman in the center of midfield, Raymond. And just so much quality coming off the bench for this Red Hawks team.
Confusion on the back line as the Red Hawks were slow to clear that away. Nobody seemed to be able to get it on their foot. But now it's back for the defensive line of the Warhawks. Neubart plays it for Zillis. Chests it down. Another long ball. Flicked on, this time by A. Olsen. Claimed by the Red Hawks. Both teams parrying it back and forth. Not too much possession here in the last 30 seconds or so. A. Olsen. Silva. Now Harwell. He has speed. Pushes it past the defender. Takes a push. The ball still in play. They'll cross it. They're looking for Follick and then Sigurdsson with the... He was right there, but the drive will go wide of the net.
And you see there a lot better opportunity there for the Warhawks, and it started by getting it out to one side of the field, then swinging it to Harwell. We've seen them be successful when they get their wings one-on-one with the man, and Harwell especially is so, so quick. He is one of the fastest men on the field, and getting a great opportunity worked there for the Warhawks.
Raymond jumped too quickly. Sigurdsson has it, and then dispossessed by Dunleavy. Raymond looking for Fulton. Cut out nicely by Vladko. Missing on the slide tackle, but then Dong will now get a foul. He is going to be charged and put into the book.
And I think that's a fair yellow card there. He went in late, and it was actually studs up. You saw him raise up his cleat there as he went by. And that one can be very dangerous. You can clip a guy on the ankle, and those can result in some serious injuries. Thankfully, Vladko able to get up after that one.
And I think if nothing else, it's exactly what you just said. The studs up are what gained Dong that yellow card. And apparently even more example of why Dong was given the yellow card, because evidently the foul actually went against Auburn Montgomery.
Yeah, and I guess there must have been a foul before that. I'm not exactly sure, but the referee says that the foul was committed by Auburn Montgomery first, and then Dong came in after he had called it already.
I think the only thing that makes sense to me is that they were actually calling the foul an advantage on that slide tackle that Dong leapt over, and then he put the challenge in. This one flicked back into play from the end line. Interesting to see how that stayed in.
Very dangerous there. Great ball in again, Raymond. The Frenchman, beautiful, beautiful ball in. And you see it headed back down. And that was the right play there by Romero. He was on the back post, and he headed it back towards his offense. If he had tried to go to goal from there, he wouldn't have gotten it in. Great header back, and no one crashing in, though.
So from the left side, it'll be another right-footed corner from Christofferson. He slices it towards goal, punched away from hit pass as he was put onto the retreat. Now the counter could be on. They find Harwell across midfield, but his touch finds Durbin. Now Dunleavy had to go in, and then a foolish foul there from Harwell. Dunleavy very upset as we see that in-swinger coming in.
Great punch out by hit pass, and that's a strong punch as well. You got to make sure when you punch those out, they clear the box, because if you just punch it a little bit, it could come back in and result in the goal. And you see there the foul by Harwell committed. It's just not a smart play. Dunleavy's coming across. He's going to get to the ball first, and you know it. And Harwell just decided to clip his ankles on that one, the back of his heels.
It was off camera there, but the head referee, Soren Stosha, having some words with Harwell. He needs to watch it so that he doesn't go in the book. Dong will crawl across the goal face. Oh, what a save from hit pass. Now another drive towards goal. But that one finds nothing but the fencing surrounding the field.
And we talked about early on how we thought hit pass looked a little uncertain on some things. But that one, an incredible save. He did not look uncertain at all. Let's watch this one again.
A great head ball there. That one looked like it was hitting the back of the net, but hit pass comes across and gets a piece of it.
And that one was actually a decent header, headed down towards the ground, and those are very hard for goalkeepers to deal with. We actually saw the Warhawks on their header in to tie it up against Lindsey Wilson, the same exact type of header right at the goalie, but it went down through his legs and deflected in. Hit pass, very, very good play to get over, slide over in position, and just get to the ground very quickly on that header.
A good play by Dong to run up and take away the short goal kick as hit pass wanted to kick it towards Vladiko, as this one is flicked on by Ayolson. And once again, Auburn Montgomery playing it in the air. Ayolson, Falik. That one is going to fall down. The goalkeeper out of position. They put it towards the post, sliding to take it away is Madrigal. It looked like it may have been going wide anyway, but nevertheless, a fantastic defensive play there from Madrigal.
Sigurdsson, oh man, he is so close on that one. If he had put maybe a little bit more power on that one, could have gone in. Fantastic stop by Madrigal.
That was dangerous. From the replay angle, it looked like it was heading right at that post. If it collides with the woodwork, you never know which way it's going to bounce. The corner comes in. Flick towards goal! Oh, there was a man at the near post again. But once again, it falls harmlessly out of play.
Great ball in by Falik, and Sigurdsson gets the first header on it. Oh, beautiful effort. Oh, man.
Neubart was there on the back post, dove for it, but the ball just would not find his foot.
We've seen how dangerous Sigurdsson has been during this national championship. Two quality chances for him, and I suspect he's going to get more. He's looked very good. Oh, man. I just cannot believe one of those didn't go in.
Now Mamadou Dia checks in for the Red Hawks. Coming off the field is Kenneth Monhey. As the Warhawks regain possession off the Red Hawk goal kick. Now they give it up to Dong. That's dangerous. He lays it back, booted up the field, and Fulton will run onto it, content just to roll it into the corner, seeking out either a long throw or a corner kick, as they do battle right there along the corner flag, and the foul will actually go against Fulton.
I have no idea how you call a foul there on him. He was just shielding the ball. He didn't put his elbows up or anything. He was just bodying with the defenders. I have no idea how you call that way. I don't think there was a foul at all on either team. That was just three guys in the corner trying to fight for the ball.
You could see it right there from the camera angle. Even Fulton pleading his case, putting his palms out.
You see the fourth official over here, one of the assistant coaches, and Jerry Cleary also getting in on the action here. They were barking at the head referee and then the fourth official, and looked very upset there.
And now a call here from the assistant referee. Stosha may have been making the call nevertheless, but the flag went up as a forearm or an elbow collided with the back of Silva's head.
And these teams, we've seen a little bit of physical play. I imagine it's only going to get more physical as the game goes on. Of course, these two SSAC opponents, and they know each other well.
Now Harwell with the steal, puts it across the area. And once again, the Red Hawks clear, but we've seen it. The Warhawks probing, seeking, pushing up. They have finally gotten something on the attack. Silva gave it away to Raymond, takes it back. Now he'll settle it down in the midfield. Puts a boot on it and now sends it to the wing. Put up by Kaiser. Raymond with that heavy left foot. Dong settles it down rather accidentally. Chested by Vladiko around one defender and a second.
Oh, man. That big man has some footwork. That was a great move to get around two guys.
Now the defender, Dunleavy, slips. That allows Follick to get a piece of it. Dia takes out his man. Again, that long foot from Raymond. This time settled purposely by Dong. The left-footed chance. Oh, skimming just wide of that post.
And what a touchdown by Dong. And then you saw on the opposite side of the field before that, Vladiko getting taken out. He's the center back, so he can't track back. He was down on the ground after a hard challenge. Nothing called. And again, the physical play, it's going to pick up here, Todd, I have a feeling.
These players putting everything they can into becoming champions. And the NAIA Champions of Character program helps students understand and embody what character truly means. It also provides student athletes, coaches, and parents the training to know, do, and value the right thing, both inside and outside of sports. Learn more about the NAIA's programs to promote character at NAIA.org.
These teams sparring in this one. We saw Martin Methodist get the momentum early with the goal, as well as just dominating possession and pressuring the entire length of the field. Whenever the Warhawks got it in their defensive third, they just saw so many defenders from this Red Hawks team getting forward and pressuring, and it swung back and forth a little bit now. Warhawks doing a lot better job of trying to possess and trying to get it up to their attacking players.
43rd minute as this goes out of play, and it'll be a throw-in for the Red Hawks. Sean Dong, the lone goal. Will it hold up? That is the question. This one settled down over on the far side. Dia dispossessed. Ayolfsson gives it right back. Parried back and forth. Now Dia is whistled on the foul.
And Dia was brought in. You see, he's a bigger body there in the center of midfield, number 20. And he was brought in kind of as a more defensive sub, I feel like, because Monhey came off and then Raymond was pushed to the wing. He's a bigger body, and he'll put in some stern tackles there in the middle of the park.
This one set high up into the air. Gets caught in the wind. Chested by Dunleavy, and he will clear. Fulton brings it down, but not with possession. Retained by Vladiko. Stepped into by Romero, and here comes Sean Dong. Long ball for Fulton, but easily controlled. Hunold was there. They were seeking Sigurdsson. He's in a defensive battle. Looking for A. Olsen, and now the foul goes against Auburn Montgomery. It's been interesting to see Soren Stosha. He's called a lot of fouls on the attacking players.
Yeah, a lot of fouls, and it's because of the high pressure of both these teams. They also, they both, whenever the other team gets the ball, they'll just send their forwards to pressure those defenders whenever they get it. And, wow, that's a great header by Norbart.
Norbart coming over the top of Dong as this one goes out of play. And that will do it as the referee was signaling for the throw-in to come further back. So Sean Dong, as we said, would you expect anyone else for these Red Hawks? He comes up huge for his team, and now they are potentially 45 minutes away from a national championship. However, the Warhawks of Auburn Montgomery have been specialists in last-second comebacks, and we mean that to the literalist degree, as they literally take every second off that clock they possibly can before they try to score that tying goal. The big question here, can the Red Hawks hold on for another 45 minutes, or will we see the second miracle in Montgomery in as many nights?
It'll be exciting to see what happens at the end of this one. And against Lindsey Wilson, Auburn Montgomery didn't look like the better team. And even the game before that, against Oklahoma Wesleyan, they didn't look like the better team. The other teams possessed the entire game and honestly looked better. And then Auburn Montgomery at the end of the game got a goal, fight back in it, and then they get another goal or send it to PKs and somehow win it. It's incredible what they've done this national championship, and it'll be Interesting to see if the same thing happens here. And so far, it's gone to script for them. Martin Methodist looking like the better team. Who knows what could happen in this second half? We've already seen some crazy things happen. Let's see what happens, Todd.
So we will send it to break and try to catch our breath a little bit here as we've had an exciting first half of soccer in the 2013 NAIA Men's Soccer National Championships. Once again, your score at halftime is Martin 1, Auburn Montgomery 0.
There's a call to be answered. The spirit of competition is still alive inside. The desire still drives. The phrase student athlete has a great ring to it. Lasting friendships are ready to be made. You just want to keep playing. Game on. Get in the game at playnaia.org.
Tra la la tra la tra la.
Italian family has their own treasured recipes. And now at Carrabba's, we're serving up two family favorites on one plate. Like our wood-grilled sirloin, topped with handmade marsala sauce and served alongside our signature chicken Brian ravioli. Or enjoy fresh ingredients and layers of flavor, all grilled over a wood fire with our Polo Rosa Maria and chicken involtini. Some of our best recipes are together at last, but only for a short time. So find your favorite tonight and come home to Carrabba's.
I had a dream. Beautiful dream, I couldn't believe how real it seemed. Up on stage in a field of green, on the winding river, and a song you'll sing. When I wake up, I'll see you in Montgomery, where dreams come true.
And welcome back to Montgomery here at the Emory Fulmer YMCA Soccer Complex. And remember, fans, the Select Super Elite is the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Select Sport America is a proud sponsor of the NAIA Men's and Women's National Soccer Coach of the Year and Player of the Year Awards. NAIA member schools are provided the opportunity to participate in the Select Sport Ball Adoption Program, where a percentage of all Super Elite sales are donated to the NAIA Champions of Character Program. Please contact your local dealer for more information on the finest hand-sewn soccer balls in the world. Select Sport America, the official soccer ball of the NAIA. And Turbo Sports Group is the official video production company of this year's national championship. Don't forget, fans, you can purchase a video download of any game from this year's national championship games with video and audio commentary available. Visit Turbo Sports online at turbosportsgroup.com. And once again, as we've done all week, we want to thank the Bonefish Grill of Montgomery. Bonefish Grill is located at the beautiful Shops of East Chase shopping area. Bonefish Grill has the best holiday gift available. When you buy $100 in gift cards, you're going to get a $20 bonus card just for yourself. For more information, stop by that Montgomery location or visit them online at bonefishgrill.com. So we're going to take one more quick break, and when we come back, we're going to run down that first half for you, give you all the inside and outside of it, and we'll also give you a detailed rundown of all that has happened within this tournament, and there has been a lot. So we'll take one more break. It's 1-0 Martin over Auburn Montgomery.
There's a call to be answered. The spirit of competition is still alive inside. The desire still drives. The phrase student athlete has a great ring to it. Lasting friendships are ready to be made. You just want to keep playing. Game on.
Get in the game at playNAIA.org.
Every Italian family has their own treasured recipes. And now at Carrabba's, we're serving up two family favorites on one plate. Like our wood-grilled sirloin, topped with handmade marsala sauce and served alongside our signature chicken Brian ravioli. Or enjoy fresh ingredients and layers of flavor, all grilled over a wood fire with our Polo Rosa Maria and chicken involtini. Some of our best recipes are together at last, but only for a short time. So find your favorite tonight and come home to Carrabba's.
I had a dream. Beautiful dream, I couldn't believe how real it seemed. Up on stage in a field of green, on the winding river, when a song you'll sing. When I wake up, I'll see you here in Montgomery, where dreams come true.
And welcome back to Montgomery, Alabama. There you saw the spot, Montgomery, the capital of dreams, and these players looking to fulfill their dream of winning a national championship. Only 45 minutes potentially stand between Martin Methodist and doing just that. But you have to figure, Josh, that the Warhawks are going to have plenty to say between those 45 minutes and when that clock ticks down to zero.
I mean, we've seen it already so many times in this national championship. You'd think the game's going to go one way. One team looks like they're dominating. Then, out of nowhere, a goal will come, tie it up, and these games have been so close and so full of goals. It'd almost be a disappointment for this one to end just 1-0. And I don't expect it to. You saw Sigurdsson getting some good chances there. I think there's at least a few... another goal or two in this game, and I'm really hoping for some more overtimes. That would be fun.
Yeah, you have to wonder, as I mentioned during the broadcast, whether or not Auburn-Montgomery had an energy lapse. They had so much emotion put into last night, scoring with literally only 1 second left up on the clock, putting everything into that, and then getting that goal late in the contest where they slipped it past Nomura by the defenders, and then Sigurdsson was able to put it home. And coming again in the 14th minute here, that is when Sean Dong scored to put Martin Methodist up in this contest. But as you said, Auburn-Montgomery seems to be finding their legs a little bit in this contest, and they seem to be finding things now on the offensive end, whereas it was slow going to open up the contest.
Yeah, and we've mentioned all these close games in this national championship. Just let me run through them here for you again. The first game, Ashford versus Baker. I believe we were both on the call for that one. And Kratham had a goal with 44 seconds left in that one to win it for Ashford. Up next, Oklahoma Wesleyan and Concordia. A goal with 8:30 to go in the second overtime. Golden goal. Oklahoma Wesleyan moves on. Next game, Rio Grande versus Embry-Riddle. PKs, Rio advances. Next game, this Auburn-Montgomery team against Benedictine. PKs, Auburn-Montgomery advances. Lindsey Wilson versus Iwu, Indiana Wesleyan. Lindsey gets a goal with 2 minutes left in that match, moves on. Hastings versus Missouri Valley College. Game winner in the last 10 seconds. I was on the call on that one. That was incredible. And that's not all. That was just the first day, believe it or not. Quarterfinals. Martin Methodist versus Belhaven, Sean Dong, game winner, 6 minutes to go before PKs in that one. And then this Auburn-Montgomery team in the quarterfinals, Kestring gets a goal with 4 minutes left before PKs. That was against Oklahoma Wesleyan to send them on. And then the semifinals, Martin Methodist and Ashford, goal with 4 seconds left to send it to overtime, and then they advance on PKs. And then the Auburn-Montgomery and Lindsey Wilson game, as we've dubbed it here, the miracle in Montgomery. Tie it with 1 second left off that cross in. I mean, that was crazy. And you see the Auburn-Montgomery fans out here again trying to cheer this team on. They're right across the street, of course. And, I mean, it's just been a crazy, crazy national championship.
And once again, as you said, we don't fully expect this game to end 1-0. But if it would be, this would be only the second clean sheet of the tournament, at least here at the final site, and I believe all tournament, because I'm pretty sure there weren't any in the first round, but I would have to double-check that. But interestingly enough, again, if this holds up, Martin would be the only team that had to clean sheets, and they would get both of them. So we're underway here in the second 45. Martin once again looking for things on the offensive end. Vladiko clears it out. The Warhawks confident in the early going at the back.
We talked about the difference that Holtus not being on the field plays. He's the number 10 for this Warhawks team. And we've seen Auburn Montgomery struggle with connecting passes. It's in large part due to that man's absence. He had the red card and he'll be on the bench for the remainder of this game as well. See if the Warhawks can work some things without him.
The Warhawks go back into retreat. And now they settle it up in the midfield. Silva, pressured initially by Dong, and now he will go back towards his wing position. Vladiko, a left-footed cross. Knocked down by Falek. Eolfsson. Kaiser into the box. Madrigal can't clear, but that one speculative.
Speculative, to say the least. But Falek, not a bad look from there. He's just trying to get a volley, get something on frame. And we haven't seen Lunny tested too much, so not a bad look.
Now we have three balls on the field. Both ball girls, plus the initial ball, came back onto the field. So confusion.
Just a little eager to help out. I like that, though. I like it.
They're on top of things. They're watching the play. You like that from your ball boys or ball girls.
Just trying to help out.
This one over the head of Raymond, but then he collects it off the foot of Kaiser. Raymond to his back line. Cleared up by Durbin. Headed clear by Vladiko. Raymond. As the Red Hawks probe forward. Now Olsen has it stolen. They will seek something up the left side. Now reversed.
You see the possession, though, here by the Warhawks is a lot better than how they started the first half, and we haven't seen a lot from them. They're doing a better job as they spray away that pass, the commentator's curse.
This one will go out. It will stay with the Warhawks. Falek hands it off to Kaiser. He wanted Eolfsson. He was not open. And once again, the throw too short, easily claimed by Madrigal to the big Scotsman. Looking for a return pass from Fulton, but that's too strong by Romero. Back to the keeper. He will hand it off to Silva.
Silva's a really fun player to watch. He'll get stuck in challenges, playing that defensive midfielder role. He's also very creative with the ball as well. He's not afraid to try some stepovers and get forward. He's been one of my favorite players to watch in this championship.
Dunleavy quick to collect that one as he had Harwell right on his back pocket. Still 1-0. Martin Methodist leads. This one put across. Lenny claims it. He had an offensive player right there. It looked like Falek who had made the run into the box, but Lenny once again confident.
Martin
Methodist
hands.
Leads. This one put across.
Very strong hands. Good job by him to get up. And I've mentioned this in the tournament many times. He's so good at keeping people out. 0.660 goals against average, and that's third in the NAIA. He's absolutely incredible, and those saves yesterday to keep them in the game. Just crazy.
As A. Olsen had his legs taken out from under him, but the ball not close enough to him for the referee to deem it an offensive chance. Once again, we want to thank Select Sport America. Select is both a broadcast sponsor of this year's national championships, but also the official soccer ball of NAIA soccer. Kaiser to the slipping Zillis. Naomi Olsen taken down from behind. The crowd very upset. They thought no foul was coming, but it is given in the end.
Powell just a little too aggressive on the back of Olsen, not letting him turn, which is what you want, but again, just getting that arm in the back, and that's pretty easy call in the end for Soren Stosha.
Sebastian Vladiko will look to put that left-footed drive into the box.
He's got a cannon.
Swings it in and cleared away. Looked like Fulton all the way back to make that clearance. And a silly play right there. It will not be called, but Soren Stosha giving some words to Yannick Falik as he put a little tug on the jersey of Lunny. Not really sure what he's accomplishing there other than letting out some frustration.
Yeah, and frustration, a very key word here as Auburn Montgomery continues to fight. Vladiko already has a yellow card for them, and Sean Dong has a yellow card for the Red Hawks as well. These teams may be going to get a little more frustrated with each other as this game goes on. We've already seen some chippy challenges. So you see them going in midfield again there. It'll be interesting to see if either one of these teams loses their cool as this game goes on.
As the Warhawks play it back to their keeper, Mathis Kroger, the hero from last night, who got that tying goal, is getting ready to check in for Auburn Montgomery.
And that is incredible. First goal of the year, first goal of his career. He's just a freshman, and what a time to get it. That young man's got to be feeling good about himself. About to check on. Maybe he could provide another moment of magic for this Warhawks team.
Looking to provide a spark on the offensive end, but you score a goal like that last night, you almost wonder if everything's downhill from there.
Maybe he can give us another last-second goal in this one.
Fulton thought he kept it into touch, but the linesman disagrees as the big Scotsman took a spill. And you hear a round of applause there. Their hero, they would not be here if it was not for him.
Very interesting substitution here. Kroger is going to go on at right back, and he's going to push Kaiser onto right mid. So AUM now playing with only two center midfielders. Actually three now as Sigurdsson drops back. But Kaiser, we've seen him at right back all national championship. Interesting to see him put out on the wing.
And Kaiser had made some runs here in the beginning of the half. And Zillis had dropped back for him. So I almost wonder if they were making that switch already. And now they just confirm it by putting Kroger on the back line. But here comes speed through the midfield. Still on the ball. Looking to drop it off. Kroger is calling for it. He'll send in the cross. Doesn't get the height on it that he would have liked after that long run from Silva.
You see why I love Silva, though. Close control, at pace, running past defenders. He's got that ability. Warhawks are going to keep playing through him, at least out of the back, and we'll see if he can make any good runs forward and maybe get himself an assist this game.
But again, despite the fact that Auburn Montgomery has pressed forward with numbers, especially in this half and even at the dying stages of the first half, no shots on goal. They have not officially tested Lunny.
Yeah, he's had to deal with a cross or two, but nothing on frame that he really has to worry about. Let's see if... And this Auburn team, that's very unusual for them. They're used to getting shots on goal and testing the keeper, and they're not afraid to have one from long range.
That was too far for Vladiko, but backtracking on the far side was Falik. Now it's on the foot, driven in towards the box, as Neubart actually played it in. Silva, a little nonchalant there, but they still have possession. Sigurdsson.
He wants it on
that
right.
Shove, he puts it to the right. It took a deflection and will go out.
And you see there, though, that's exactly what he wants to do. They thought he was going to maybe take it line and put it on his left for a cross in. Instead, he puts it on his right And he's got the ability to either power that or try and finesse it back post. And you got to keep him in front of you if you're one of the defenders for the Redhawks.
So Falek will take the drive. He will put it in right-footed. Swings it across goal. There's a man there. And once again, it falls right to the keeper.
The big man, E. Olfsson, in there. And there's a man down in the goal. There's a lot of collisions in the middle of that box.
It looks like it's either Durbin or Powell who's in the box. And you called it right. E. Olfsson went in, got the head to it, but it almost looked on the replay that so he closed his eyes and just kind of hoped that it hit him, which it did. But obviously, if you don't know where the ball is, you're not going to direct it where you'd like.
E. Olfsson, though, gives them that big body off the bench. And if they get corners, they're probably going to be looking to him or Vladiko.
Well, that's cut out nicely by Hunold. Sends a long ball up, but that's well too far for Kestring.
Now Warhawks have it with a good opportunity here, though, in the attacking third. See if they can work something.
Now they get it to Sigurdsson. He took that right foot shot, which he's looking for. But the defense knows that he wants that, and they step in front.
And he had a lot of space in front of him. They are very lucky to get in front of that shot. He just needs that yard of space. We've already seen it in this tournament.
Remember, fans, we want to make sure you check out more exciting action of other NAIA national championships going on right now, as we speak, in fact, sometimes, at NAIA.org. The men's soccer and volleyball national championships are available now. Go to the NAIA website for more information.
Yeah, a lot of exciting championships going on. A lot of football being played today as well. But it hasn't stifled the Auburn-Montgomery crowd. A lot of them still showing up.
As Lunny claims this one again, and we thank all the fans who are watching here. Obviously, with today's technology, you can probably have about four or five different screens in front of you in your home, but we appreciate those that are watching us when there are so many other options available. Now Silva as the Warhawks. Look for something, but they're very deliberate on the ball, not wanting to give it away. Hunold for Vladiko. Once again, good footwork from the big man.
And now you see him go up into the center of midfield. They're not afraid to push Vladiko up and see what he can do. And he can do quite a lot. He's got good footwork and a long shot as well.
Kroger thought he had a bit more space along the near side, puts it out of play. Ramon loses it to his number counterpart. Now here's Sigurdsson, center of the park. Finds A. Olsen just too far.
Great slotted through ball, and if you have Kestring up there, maybe you can work something to him, but E. Olsen isn't usually going to get on those through balls. He's just not as quick. He's a bigger guy. Not a bad look, though, by Sigurdsson.
Now Kroger brought it down. Didn't know too much about it, but it settled for him. Far side with Neubart. To Silva and back. Up the wing. Harwell leaves it off for Neubart. A good give and go here. Neubart streaking towards the box. He's taken down. There is no whistle.
And I'm kind of surprised myself. It might have been shoulder to shoulder, but that one's an iffy call. That one's a hard one for the referee to call because they're all running at pace and things might have just gotten tangled up. Oh, man. I still can't tell from that replay. It was so quick. It was a bang-bang call. And
head referee Soren Stosha shaking his finger no all the way, but that is a brave call there, or no call, as it were. It looked like Neubart had the step on the defender. Brought down by A. Olsen, looking for Sigurdsson. He's dangerous, cut out. And again, no call, much to the chagrin of the Warhawk fans.
Yeah, but that time I agree with the no call. That was a fantastic tackle. And that was Powell on that one. Powell and Durbin, the rocks in the back for this Red Hawks side.
Hunold will carry it across midfield, splits his teammates, but this one driven well out of play.
Warhawks again, though, looking more positive. They're playing it forward, they're getting it forward, and they're getting it in more dangerous positions. This is much better than the first half for them, and you can hear the crowd spurring them on, really trying to get something. As Harwell turns for that shot. A great turn, and just couldn't keep it down. His head was up as that one was going upward as well.
So it goes out of play. It'll be a goal kick and be taken by Lunny. Once again, congratulations to him on being named the All-American Academic Player of the Year for the NAIA. Madrigal with the flick off the head. Raymond gives the official a bit of a shove to get out of the way. Now the Warhawks have it. Here's Kaiser. He'll send one across the area. Sigurdsson as the defense swarms. Silva to Kroger. He'll put a right foot, stepped into by Teixeira, and that will go out of play for the corner.
And again, the Warhawks looking so much more positive, and it's good to see. And Sigurdsson got it out on that wing, couldn't work anything. You saw there the immediate pressure once he got the ball. He had four Red Hawks around him, and that's the center midfielders being active. They're doing a great job for this Red Hawk side of just trying to cut things out before they happen, especially if it's on the foot of that man.
Now Follick puts it, a low cross, that's easily cleared away by Raymond, but he took a knock right on the left leg and he goes down in the box. Teixeira, the long ball. Monhey had pace, but not enough to collect it.
That was a big chance to counter for the Red Hawks after the corner kick. There weren't a lot of defenders back for the Warhawks, and now another chance to break.
Now Silva, for the second time, denies Monhey.
And you see the bit of skill. That's lovely. I mean, Silva, you know why I like him. He's skillful. He's tiny, too, and just able to glide by guys. Little step over and then draws the foul. He's just an awesome player. He would be on my all-tournament team.
So the Warhawks pressuring here as Silva will stay deep into the midfield to try to counter any counterattack. High up in the air. Hey, Olsen gets a piece of it and swept away. Silva calls off his teammate. Now sends it up to Neubart. The left-footed cross looking for Olsen. He settled it, but with too much weight. Silva again. Neubart back to Silva. They will push it near side for Kroger. He'll send in the long ball. Looking again for Olsen. Gets it. Oh, it's touched over. The fans thought it might have gone in, but a fantastic save there. Lunny proving why he is the player of the year.
What a ball in by Kroger, and Olsen rising high onto his head. And you got to give credit to Lunny on that one. Fantastic tip over.
Now it's headed in again. This one wide.
And there was the goal scorer from last night, the hero, Mathis Kroger, on the back post. That one, oh man, the Warhawks looking a lot better now. They're attacking, and we've seen Martin Methodist kind of step off the gas pedal a little bit.
Coach Cleary a little bit nervous on the near sideline, upset with his team's effort. They have not pushed forward in a good 2 minutes, I would say. Again, Auburn Montgomery, they've done this all tournament. As this one, you see, that's the corner kick, and that one goes just wide. This one will go.
We see a foul committed there on the far side. That was Neubart, and just going in late on that tackle, and will be a free kick here for Raymond. And we already know he can swing some into the box. He had one that was swung into the box that was disallowed that went into the goal. And he's got a chance to do something very important here.
Coach Cleary having a lot of words for the fourth official here. Not sure what he's so upset about, as his team was given the free kick unless he felt a booking should have happened. Christofferson pushed off by Sigurdsson. Here comes the big man. He tries to find Harwell. He had space, but the ball hit a piece of turf and wouldn't settle down.
Oh, great tracking back by Raymond. Oh, and Silva is elbowed here.
The Frenchman upset with the call, and again, Coach Cleary for Martin Methodist upset as well.
And we've seen Silva go down a lot in this national championship, and sometimes I'm not sure if it's a foul. Sometimes Silva milking it for all it's worth. But Raymond, good tracking back there, and then it's got to be careful throwing elbows in there as you're running.
I wonder if that's one of those things, though, that Silva a bit shorter than compared to Redmond. Redmond probably swinging his arm just in the natural flow of running, but happened to catch Silva across the face. But nevertheless, the foul rightfully given. This one dangerous into the mic. They score! Once again, the hero, Kroger. Mathis Kroger, and it's 1-1.
The hero from last night and another miracle in Montgomery. The crowd going wild, and what other time during the season would you want to score goals? He hasn't scored all year long. He's a freshman, and he just decides, I guess I should get some header goals in the national championship during the finals. I mean, just look at that. Gets his head around and just a little flick on. He just really helped the ball on in the end, and Lunny just flat-footed. Nothing he could do about it. And I told you there would be another goal or two in this one, and it just makes it more exciting for you watching at home and then the crowd out here. And now Martin Methodist has to push guys forward again, so we'll see what happens.
Full marks to you for calling that one out, but you have to appreciate the slipperiness of Mathis Kroger finding a hole in between the defenders. You have to wonder about their ability should that have not been cleared away, but again, Lindsey Wilson could say the same. And they have been bitten by the same snake as Mathis Kroger finds his way in, puts just a little bit of a flick to it. Lunny had no chance.
And this tournament has been a broadcaster's dream. You've just got storyline on top of storyline. Both these teams played so well during this one. It's just absolutely incredible. And the man, Mathis Kroger, I mean, what else can you say? Man of opportunity, and he's taken them well.
Good. Auburn-Montgomery picking a little bit earlier time to equalize here tonight. They have not done it in the last 15 minutes. There were 25 minutes and some seconds left up on the clock when they equalized. But only their second shot on goal, and they score from it. They are quick. Now here comes Sigurdsson. He's taken down, or rather fell to ground, and the official will let play continue.
Yeah, that's a good call by the head referee, Soren Stosch. A great piece of skill there by Raymond.
Raymond, the spin around Kaiser, and will retain. Looking up near wing, that will be too strong for Dong, or will it? He had the pace to catch up to that one, and Vladiko had to be careful.
That's scary pace there by Sean Dong. I mean, and we've seen he hasn't gotten the ball here in this second half as much, and he looked dangerous, like he's going to get a goal every time he went forward earlier in the game. Redhawks will have to play him back in if they want to get a goal here in the second half.
Sean Dong always dangerous. Even when the defense thinks they have him covered, he finds a way to get that ball and make something happen. And he will have to do so. He's already got the goal, but he has been equalized. 1-1 is your score. And once again, fantastic soccer here at the 2013 NAIA National Championships. Fans have definitely got their money's worth, whether here live or watching on New Lion, presented by Turbo Sports.
And we're just lucky enough to be up here in the booth calling it. It's been awesome. These teams, I mean, the final, for either one of these teams, if they win, it's the first time national championship for either side. They're going to give it their all here in the last 20 or so minutes of this game. I'm just lucky enough to be watching the rest of it, as always.
First finals appearance for any of these players out there. Auburn Montgomery as a program has been in four finals, but those were back in the last time they were there was 2000, 2001, and then 04. But Martin Methodist making their first finals appearance as a program. On the men's side, anyway.
Yeah, the women's side, of course. Jerry Cleary, he's got experience in these title games. Two national championships with the women's team of Martin Methodist.
A fantastic slide tackle there from Kaiser to cut out that long ball. They were looking for Raymond. Now here's Neubart. He'll find A. Olsen. He tried to slip one across. Kaiser was making the run, but too many black jerseys.
And you see how isolated Dong is up there. They try and get it to him, but even if he gets it up there, I know he's skillful, but he's got to go against three defenders. Martin Methodist dropping back into their half a lot when AUM gets the ball now.
Now Raymond, the referee says play on. Diving for it is Falick. He will not collect with it. And now A. Olsen taken down in the midfield.
The big man falls hard. And that was Madrigal going in with the tackle. But Olsen, great hold-up play to get back to the ball and great body.
Once again, recapping very quickly, Sean Dong scored in the first half in the 14th minute, answered by the hero, Mathis Kroger, in the 36th minute. Now check that. That was the yellow card. The goal comes in the 64th minute. This one crossed in again, and that one cleared away by the defense. Martin Methodist in the black jerseys with white trim on the shoulders, heading right to left, countered by Auburn Montgomery in the orange with white trunks as they go left to right.
Oh, Silva, beautiful move.
Almost controlled there, knocked away. This one skied over the frame. And we will have a goal kick.
Another optimistic one there by Falick, but that one was long enough and it was dropping. And really not a bad look, actually, in the end.
65th minute here. 1-1 is your score. That one is knocked down by Kaiser. A. Olsen looking for Sigurdsson. He has it on the right foot. Slides it through to Harwell. Guarded closely. Dunleavy right there. Harwell looking for space. Sigurdsson takes the drive. Blocked. Sigurdsson again cuts it past the defender. Diving in. There is, again is no call. Harwell will collect in the corner. Dunleavy on him once more. And back to Neubart. Silva, Dong was close to it. A left-footed drive towards goal. I believe he was actually going for A. Olsen, ends up into the hands of Lunny.
Sigurdsson and Harwell doing a great job on that touchline on the far side, and they both know how to score goals, leading goal scorers for this Warhawks team. Expect one of them to get through and have more opportunities.
Vladiko. Very confident in his abilities to keep control of that ball as Dong was right there. Vladiko heard the footsteps, took a look around, but if that ball slides just barely by him, Dong is off to the races. Now a low pass finds Kaiser. He'll continue it through. Sigurdsson finds it just past Monhe and too strong for A. Olsen.
And man, he sure had Harwell out on that wing. He was trying to find him, but cut out well by the Red Hawks.
And the Red Hawks step into the clearance. This time Durbin gets a right boot to it. Monhe gets the return pass, puts it past the defender. Return feed from Dong. Too much on it again. The Warhawks clear it out. Neubart to Harwell and back. Looking towards Falick. Silva, Dong again, trying to pressure him. Trying to force a mistake. Silva taken down. Advantage called. They play it through to Harwell. But once again, too much pace on the ball. It will go out.
And that is the exact ball you want from Sigurdsson. Find Harwell running through. Harwell's got to make that diagonal run in behind the defense. But, oh, a perfectly slotted through ball, just a little less on that, and Harwell's got a chance at a goal.
While we have a little bit of a break, once again, we want to thank the Bonefish Grill, one of this year's broadcast sponsors. The Bonefish Grill, located at the Shops at East Chase right here in Montgomery. Enjoy spinach bacon gorgonzola Atlantic salmon, grilled steak and lobster duet, or, of course, the ever-popular Bang Bang shrimp. Again, that's the Bonefish Grill, located at the Shops at East Chase right here in beautiful Montgomery, Alabama. A long seeking ball, flicked on by Romero, but he took a push from the back. So that will allow Kaiser to take it. Played up, and actually the ball came from Vladiko. Kaiser looking for Harwell. Dunleavy got a foot to it, didn't know too much about it as it just goes out of play.
A lot of pressure here from the Warhawks. They have been on the front foot this entire half.
Here is the hero, a cheeky little flick on towards Kaiser, but he stepped on the ball, may have rolled an ankle.
Oh, and that one looks really painful. He tried to get back up after it, but Kaiser. And the coach is Jerry Cleary upset that the referee stopped play for that one. But Kaiser, that looked really ugly when he rolled his ankle on that ball. That could have been a lot worse. I'm glad to see he's walking, though.
Interesting. He came back on the field, but once the trainer comes out, he has to take a step off. So they will be down a man, at least for a few seconds, until Stosha beckons him back on. That will push Kroger up from his backline spot to cover Ramon. Fulton getting ready to check in.
There is Jerry Cleary on the sideline. But Martin Methodist will get the ball back.
And now Kaiser beckoned back onto the field, so back to a full 11 for the Warhawks. As this one settles down, if not accidentally, Silva still in control. Sigurdsson on the attack. The defense pours around him. He gets it across, diving out to smother it was Lunny.
That is a fantastic save. And Sigurdsson, what a run down the wing. Just the same touch forward every time. You see it here, and Eolfsson was charging in as well. Lunny made sure he was the first man to it, and he's been outstanding in this national championship.
Wiping the sweat from his brow, but he claims that that shot was a piece of cake.
He makes it look easy the way he plays goalkeeper sometimes, but he's had a few good saves now in this game. He's had so many during this tournament, and great goalkeeper. Great guy to have between the pipes back there.
As we are in the 74th minute now. Kaiser, leave it, and now the foul will go against Falik, or were they calling a handball?
No, that was a foul, and you saw Falik reach up across the face and neck area of Teixeira there, and yeah, that one's going to be a pretty easy call. A little frustration there from Falik, I think.
I saw the official motioning to his hand, wasn't sure what that was indicating, but Christofferson will drive it across the area. Headed out nicely by the defense. Dong will chase it down on the wing. Fakes a drive back towards the box. Now sends it in. Up high in the air. Dangerous here. Flicked out. And now the Warhawks will counter. Harwell. Along the wing. A long ball for Olsen. Bravely sliding it away was Durbin.
And that was the fastest I've seen Eolfsson run the entire game. That was incredible. He almost got onto the end of that one.
And that was actually Christofferson, as we want to rightly give credit to him for that defensive play. Now a long ball, but that one was hopeful at best, as that went about 5 yards over the goal.
Yeah, not a bad effort once again, at least from that range, not a bad effort. The shot in the end left a lot to be desired, but when you're at that range and running forward at pace, sometimes it pays to have a long shot, and we've seen these Warhawks with a lot of long shots in this tournament.
Just a shade over 13 and a half minutes left in this half. Potentially someone's season if they can find a goal. hit pass. We haven't mentioned his name in a long time, and that goes to show you how much on the attack the Warhawks have been. Now Neubart from the left back. Back through center. Dangerous there as Fulton was right on it. Now here comes Silva. With the absence of holdouts, Silva has become that midfield general. A long ball off the throw finds the Olsen. To Kaiser. Steps over it, pushes it to the left foot, hauled down, and now the foul is given. It was not initially. That's an interesting call to give it at the end there, because if it wasn't called initially, that should have been a handball on Kaiser as he reached out and grabbed that ball.
Yeah, and the players got tangled up on the ground there, and there was definitely some back and forth between the both of them. And I think rightly called in the end.
It did look like there was a foul there, but I've always wondered as to the wisdom of grabbing that ball with your hand when you suspect a foul will be given, because if it's not, then you give the kick to your opponent.
And now standing over this is Falik and Vladiko, and remember, Vladiko had the cross in the miracle in Montgomery. Let's see if he can do something here.
He'll put it across the face of goal, swings in, but Lunny right there to claim it.
And that's a very good look, because it's on frame, and let's say a defender gets in front of that and blocks Lunny's view, you never know what could happen. That one could drop in, and Lunny, once again, huge save.
Romero will nod it on, blasted back up into the air. And now the linesman's flag goes up. Offsides is the call.
And it's been a very interesting half, almost polar opposite of what we saw in the first half. Martin Methodist just hasn't had anything going forward. They've barely gotten it to their attacking players. Raymond, Dong, they haven't touched it as much. And again, polar opposite of the first half. Warhawks fighting through.
Flicked down by Romero, dangerously taken down by Vladiko. He's injured. He's hopping on one leg. Shot towards goal. Hit pass covers. It's loose. And hit pass reclaims. Fulton was right there. The ball was in his sights, but he could not get a boot to it.
And hit pass is very lucky on that one. That one ran through, as you see the replay here. An excellent shot from that distance. Oh, and punched away Vladiko. What a play by him to just poke it away from Fulton, because if he gets any kind of contact on that, Martin Methodist is up 2-1.
And once again, we want to give credit to the defenders there. The Silva backtracking from the midfield, getting in front of the bigger man, the big Scotsman, Fulton. As apparently there was a stoppage in play. That was...
Yeah, I think the goalkeeper hit pass was wiping something off there, and the referee called it dead. He'll just drop it back into play, though, for hit pass.
So questions abound for both teams. We're at square one. We started off 0-0. Now it is 1-1. With Martin Methodist scoring the opening goal, they were seemingly in control, possessing, having all the attacks on their side. The Warhawks pressured. They answered. So now, can the Red Hawks, as my voice apparently wants to leave, can the Red Hawks spring Sean Dong for that go-ahead goal in regulation?
And I mean, it's been such a crazy tournament. I'm not surprised your voice is leaving you here at the end. Mine's been hoarse after a couple of these calls, and it's just been an absolutely exciting championship. And then this game here at the end, all knotted up here going into the end of the game. And at this point, if any goal came, it would be almost as exciting as we've already had, which is hard to imagine.
And again, you mentioned how many goals there have been in this tournament that have come in the last 15 minutes alone, let alone all the goals that have come in overtimes and double overtimes. These games just come right down to the wire, and the fans for both of these squads cannot have any fingernails left.
And again, we've had a record for most overtimes, double overtimes, and penalty kicks in this national championship. 15 games have gone into overtime. It's absolutely incredible.
A little push pass for Kaiser, but too slow, so Madrigal will chase him down. Now joining the fray was Romero, still in. Oh, and that looks dangerous there from Kroger. He is down. I believe his foot got caught up in a divot as he lunged for that ball. Oh, and he's holding a knee.
And a lot of tackles are going in here.
As this one is skied up and over the goal. I'm actually not sure if that ever went out of play unless it deflected off of one of the posts behind the netting. But he is just writhing in pain. And I think something's... You always hate to speculate, but I think something is gone there.
And now a red card, a straight red card from one of the players on the bench for AUM.
Not sure who that was. They have a penny on. It may actually be one of the...
And it's one of the injured players on the bench for Auburn Montgomery. And you could hear some of the people from the bench yelling at the referee, and it actually wasn't for anything that happened to Mathis Kroger. He did that on the field of play. It was actually a play that happened earlier in the back. One of the center backs just got completely taken out by Fulton after he cleared the ball away, and it was hard to see because it was after the play, but he cleared the ball up, and then it was kind of like a late hit on the quarterback in football. After he released the ball, someone just came in and cleared his legs out. And I think that's why they were all yelling at the referee initially. He just waved play on, though.
And to get a straight red, you have to figure that whoever that was that we saw leaving the facility, because a red card, you're not allowed to stay on the bench anymore. But you have to figure that there were at least one magic word said to the official, if not several.
And as a player on the bench who's not going to see the field at all, and someone who's injured and just there, you don't want to do anything like that. You want your coaches to address the referee. You don't yourself want to take a red card for that sort of action.
And you really feel there for Mathis Kroger. Obviously, this was going to be the last game of the season, win or lose, but you could see the emotion on his face, whether through pain or the emotion of not being able to continue, because he knows that, I think, as much as he felt for that, something had to have happened. I think something popped, something snapped. He was just writhing in pain, and it seemed to be one of those situations that we see all too often in sports these days. A knee goes, and you know it right away.
Yeah, and a sub came on for him. I believe it was number 23, Johnson, for coming on for the first time that I've seen in this tournament.
Dagger Janssen taking his spot for Mathis Kroger, and Coach Koch reaching into his bag of tricks, trying to pull out some people that will continue his team in this championship final.
And I mean, there's been so many injuries on this team. A lot of guys with knocks, too, that we've seen in these games. As the pace from Harwell gets down the wing. But again, this AUM team, they're carrying a lot of knocks. We've seen their guys go down a lot under tackles. And it's amazing to see them playing this well at the end of a national championship in which they've given everything.
Now Sigurdsson lays it back. Silva. Madrigal following it step for step. Played forward from Falik. Right to the defender. Now the long ball was intended for Dong, but betraying him and going out of play.
As the time ticks down here, we get closer and closer to either a last-second goal or going into overtime and something crazy happening there. I mean, we've seen it all tournament long, and these teams are not going to quit going at each other.
Raymond will send a long one for Fulton, but he attacked slicing across the field instead of following the ball up the field. Powell nods it away, but not out. Ayolson to Sigurdsson. He takes a drive. The defender steps into it. Dunleavy right back on top of it. Now the Redhawks look to claim it. They have not had much possession here. Cheekily put around Kaiser by Raymond. He will drop it for Madrigal. Fulton settles it down. It's poked away. Sprays right side. Raymond off of Harwell. And actually, they're going to say it bounced back off of Raymond, so quick throw comes in from the Warhawks.
You saw Raymond upset about that one. He didn't think he touched it out.
Now Madrigal slices it through the defense. Here comes Fulton. Drops it to Teixeira. A long ball straight towards Dong, but stepped into by Neubart.
Yeah, and again, Dong just not seeing the ball enough. They've had a hard time finding him, and you got to credit AUM. They've covered him up.
As we approach 80 minutes played, each team has a goal. Will we see a further overtime game? We've had a record of those in this NAIA tournament, 15 overtime games, 13 double overtime games, 6 have gone to PKs, all of those NAIA records.
And a hard tackle put in there on the end line. That's going to be a quick yellow. And I believe that's Janssen. Yeah, he's getting his first action on the field and then going in with the slide tackle and getting an early yellow.
So the referee took quick note of Janssen stepping onto the field, and within, I would say, about 2 minutes, he gets his yellow card into the book.
And he's going to go right off the field. And I'm surprised we haven't seen this guy earlier on, Kestring, coming back on. They got the goal, so they didn't need him to come back on, but still one of the best players for the Warhawks.
You have to wonder if he's a bit banged up or if that was just to give him an extra rest for these final moments. But as you said, Kestring, an extended seat on the bench, but now being put into crunch time.
Yeah, Yolfson actually started out the half at that target forward spot that Kestring usually plays at.
So the free kick just north of midfield from the Red Hawks' perspective. Towards the top of the box, about 5 yards away. Now Dunleavy.
Oh.
Shouldered by Sigurdsson, and that is a foul all day long.
And Dunleavy with a great touch around, but Sigurdsson just lowering the boom on that one. That looked like a hit stick on Madden.
I have to wonder if that's what some people refer to as a professional foul. I think Sigurdsson knew he was going to be beat, took out the man, let his defense come in behind him.
Yeah, just led with the shoulder. The ball was well by him. And Dunleavy with a nice bit of skill. The outside back has been very impressive for this Red Hawks team.
The always dangerous left foot of Raymond puts it towards goal. It's loose once again and finally smothered by Hit Pass.
And Raymond once again with a beautiful ball into the box, and Hit Pass, oh, he coughed it up for a second. He made sure he didn't again, though, and smothered it afterwards.
And you see here, driven in towards goal, not able to get it the first time on the second attempt just before Fulton could get there. Lenny will spike it away. Romero got the touch. Raymond guiding traffic. Far side. Dong couldn't get ahead to it. There's still a man in the box. And cut away by the defender. That may have been Vladiko.
That was extremely dangerous to let the ball bounce in the box like that. As a defender, you're taught to never let that ball drop in the box. Don't let it bounce twice, which it did. And Romero, oh man, he was sniffing out on that one. And we've seen him, he had a header goal earlier in this national championship, so he knows how to put it in the back of the net.
Again, dangerous. Romero with the left foot, put towards goal, spiked away. It's off of Hit Pass. It's still loose in the box, finally cleared away. And it will go out for another corner.
If you're Martin Methodist, you have no idea how that didn't go in. Watch this one. Into the box. There's three guys back there. Cleared off the line and then into Hit Pass his own face.
Back to live action. Swung it again. And this one headed over the goal. But again, the only thing we've said wrong with hit pass, we've questioned his positioning. He came out to try to punch the ball, missed it, and then he is about 4 yards away from his end line, and his defender actually puts the ball off his chest. That's not the position you want to be in as a goalkeeper.
And that's why you have a guy on the back post, though. Great job getting in front of that one, because there were three Red Hawks back there waiting to pounce.
88th minute here. They look the long ball for Harwell, and that will be poked out of play. They get it quickly back into Harwell. Kaiser puts it across the face of goal. He had a Olsen in there, but just too high. Now put back in by Vladiko. It takes a flick off of head, but nobody kept the run on, and Lunny claims it.
And we're either heading to overtime or having some crazy last-second goal here. And it's going to come through one of these superstar players for either team. I'd look for Sean Dong on one end or Sigurdsson to get a goal at the end of this game.
Now the long ball from Raymond. Trying to test hit pass. He was a little bit too far out of frame, but always under it to claim.
That's a good effort, though, by Raymond. I mean, just to have the ambition to try something like that from outside.
You have to believe Martin knows what Auburn Montgomery is capable of, trying to keep it as far away from their own goal as possible. But here comes Falik. Long service. He was looking for Aolfsson. He did not know where the ball went after it was cleared up. Silva on it. Puts a drive in. Dunleavy clears, and Kristoffersen further so. Neubart lost the ball to Dong. It's dropped for Teixeira. The long ball to the far side. Dong will run onto it. Neubart giving chase. Right foot across, and that will go out of play. So once again, we continue to further push the envelope on the record here. We now have 16 overtime games, as this one, after 90 minutes, 1-1.
I mean, a broadcaster's dream to have these type of games and this type of national championship, it is incredible. Todd, what else do you want to say about it?
I think we've used up all the adjectives in the thesaurus, and we're going to have to try to find some new ones as play will continue here. But we're going to take one quick break, let our sponsors have one more time to shine. And when we come back, we will have overtime soccer for you in the 2013 NAIA National Championship Finals.
There's a call to be answered. The spirit of competition is still alive inside. The desire still drives. The phrase, student-athlete, has a great ring to it. Lasting friendships are ready to be made. You just want to keep playing. Game on. Get in the game at playnaia.org.
Tra-la-la-tra-la-tra-la.
Italian family has their own treasured recipes. And now at Carrabba's, we're serving up two family favorites on one plate. Like our wood-grilled sirloin, topped with handmade marsala sauce and served alongside our signature chicken Brian ravioli. Or enjoy fresh ingredients and layers of flavor, all grilled over a wood fire with our Polo Rosa Maria and chicken involtini. Some of our best recipes are together at last, but only for a short time. So find your favorite tonight and come home to Carrabba's.
I had a dream, a beautiful dream. I couldn't believe how real.
it seems. Up on stage in a field of green, on the winding river, in a song you'll sing. When I wake up, I'll see you, you in Montgomery, where dreams come true.
And welcome back to Montgomery, Alabama. We're coming to you live from the Emory Fulmer YMCA Soccer Complex. And what a game we've had for you here. But would you expect any more or any less? The way this tournament has proceeded to roll forth before our eyes, and we've seen so much overtime soccer that you almost don't expect any game to end in 90 minutes anymore.
Yeah, well, what else would you want other than 20 more minutes of overtime and then maybe penalty kicks? I mean, it's been crazy. We've seen so many games in this national championship, and as you mentioned before the break, 16 overtime games now. It's just, it's really unheard of. but it's been a lot of fun, Todd. I'm very excited to see how the rest of this one shakes out.
Definitely fun, to say the least, and we feel privileged to be able to bring it to you live here on New Lion, presented by Turbo Sports. Giving you just a quick recap here, the first goal came in roughly the 14th minute, and it came from, who else would you expect from Martin Methodist, Sean Dong. Then we had a couple yellow cards in between that, one for each team respectively, but then the game kept pressing on, but so did the Warhawks. They kept pushing forward, seeking something out. Finally, they would find it, and it would be the hero of last night becoming the hero again tonight. He won't have a further chance because Mathis Kroger got that injury. Looked to be a knee injury. You have to figure he is done for the evening. But he has given his team an opportunity to continue to play for a national championship. And then just a quick update on that red card. Not that it really means much because the player was injured, but it was handed out to Tayan Souza for the Auburn-Montgomery Warhawks. But they line up. The coaches have given the instructions, and you almost wonder if Coach Cleary and Coach Koch have even anything to say left. They've played so many overtime periods now. Do they even have any instruction left?
At this point, you've just got to tell them, boys, go out there and play, and let's see if we can get another win. And I don't know if there's anything else that needs to be said. These guys, these young men, have played outstanding in this national championship so far, and hats off to them. They've put on a great show.
They've taken it about as far as they can go, but still a few more steps further. Do they have the energy? Do they have the will? As here is Monhey. He tries to slice in front, and much to the disappointment, to put it nicely, of the fans, there will be a free kick given, and this will be in an extremely dangerous position.
And that was just an awkward challenge by Hunold. He came out and kind of just bundled into the man, and now Christofferson's going to stand over this free kick and see if he can swing one into a dangerous area. And from this distance, I would go ahead and put it on frame if I were Christofferson, and we know he's got the technique to do it.
Now Christofferson will go back post, punched away confidently by Hit Pass. Now another shot, but that one was never on target.
Yeah, and that one, he was looking for the head of one of his teammates.
Christofferson will go
way.
Back hit post, pass. Punched Great away punch, confidently by Hit Pass.
And then Raymond.
Now another shot.
Long shot, nowhere near the frame, but Hit Pass stepping up big. He's had a few saves as well. These keepers for either team, Lunny for the Red Hawks and Hit Pass for the Warhawks, they've been outstanding in this game.
Hit Pass definitely the future of this program, only a freshman stepping in for the injured senior, Vinier Johansson.
And those are big shoes to fill, big gloves to fill, if I may. Johansson, an All-American first-teamer last year.
Harwell goes to ground a bit easy right there, but the official giving him the benefit of the doubt. And now it'll be a free kick from about, oh, I'd say 20 yards outside of the area.
Does this spot look at all familiar to you, Todd?
I think it might have been a little closer to the line the last time, but this is exactly the scenario of which Vladiko put that ball in. And Kroger buried it last night.
Vladiko has great service from these. He's going to call Falik off it because he wants it. Very dangerous for the Warhawks.
Arm up in the air. Down. Kick coming forth. And it's punched away. Silva right back in and knotted out again. I think Fulton got a piece of it. Bicycle back towards the area. We're all in alone, but offsides. An easy call there for the linesman as there were about three orange jerseys all alone.
And I don't know if Lunny heard the whistle because once someone put it past towards the goal, as you see the replay here. Oh, Silva had a great chance at this too. That's a great shot and cleared away by one of the center backs.
There's the bicycle back towards the area.
And watch Lunny here. they poke it past, and Lunny didn't hear the whistle, I don't think. He went all the way back and made sure that one didn't go in the goal.
Loose in the midfield. Picked up by Ramon to the near side for Monhe. He'll take it straight at the defender, and Kaiser denies. Ramon peels it back. Pressured by Harwell, tugs on the shoulder, gets away with it. Now Olsen looking for options. Falik, Sigurdsson will take it to the left. Nobody over there, surprisingly. Sigurdsson has to retreat to Silva. Neubarth along the touchline. Long ball into the box, looking for Olsen. Lunny out to get it. Harwell is there, takes the shot, it's off a body. Oh, my. That was Madrigal, I believe, down on the ground, and Harwell put the shot right into him.
And watch this replay. Harwell gets on the end of it. Oh, what a play there.
And that was actually either Durbin or Powell. Again, hard to tell. Madrigal was in the area. But once again, those center backs saving Martin's season, at least for the moment. The fans banging, chanting, pressing their team on. They will have to wait a few more moments. Sigurdsson, he left it for his teammate Silva, but that was pushed away.
Oh, chance to break.
Now numbers forward, and the foul comes a bit late.
And that was a 3-on-2 opportunity. If Kristofferson could have found something, that was a very dangerous opportunity for the Red Hawks.
Displeasure in the voice of the Warhawks fans, but I think the right call was made.
And again, that one was so dangerous. They were breaking after that free kick.
This one high in the air, loose in the box. Dong wanted the kick. He's taken down inside the area. No call coming. That one goes off the official. Now a battle just outside the attacking third for Martin. Again, bodies colliding, everybody going to ground. This one loose, long shot from Raymond, but he puts it well off target. And now we get a stoppage in play and another card coming. It will go to Neubart.
And you see Fulton there shaking off the handshake by Neubart.
He wanted absolutely no part of that.
And that's two players who are just in the heat of competition. Fulton probably not going to be shaking their hands until the end of this game.
So hit pass, sees what options are available, and blasts it out from the goal kick. Now the long ball, knotted down by Hunold. And they were looking for the big man up top, but A. Olsen was not quick enough or tall enough to catch up to that. 4 minutes remain. We've played 96 minutes in this contest and still no winner.
As we push further into this game, into this first overtime, and it may head to the double overtime, and once again the drama just heightens a little bit more.
Kaiser boots it high in the air. Raymond claimed it for the Red Hawks. Nicely brings it down. Monhe will track into the corner. Left-footed cross. Oh, he had a man there. That slipping and falling was Fulton, and that allows the defense to send it away. Now the counter was almost on for Harwell, but he could not control. Lunny with pressure on him. Fulton. No, that was Raymond, but he does not collect. Sent away by Powell. Fulton avoids the back check. Quickly streaking up the line is Dunleavy. Into the box. Dong sends it across. Fulton with a drive. It's high up in the air, punched away by hit pass. Still loose in the area. Monhey drops it back. One-time shot. They score! Raymond with the game winner, and what a shot. That's the way you want to end a tournament.
That was a fantastic strike from outside. Watch this series of events unfold. Monhey's going to get it, and Raymond, who's been playing on the wing all game, drops back, sits at the top of the box, and then watch this. Finesse. Hit pass can only flap an arm at it. And Raymond, the Frenchman, his first goal in the national championship, and it was a fantastic one.
As we watch the players celebrate, the season is over for both these teams. What effort put forth.
And a first national championship for this Martin Methodist Red Hawk team. And actually the first national championship title in any men's sport for this Martin Methodist college team. A great job, guys. You have had a fantastic season. And they extend the winning streak to 13 games and carry it on into next season as well. Just a great effort by them in this national championship. And we haven't seen them let off the gas pedal in any of these games. They've played hard. Talk about players like Sean Dong, Fulton up top, and then the man who scored the goal, Raymond. And that is fantastic. You hear some of the Martin Methodist fans down on the field. And they are a good contingent from them. They didn't have too many people in the first few games, but came down for the championship. And this is what it's all about.
And again, none of these teams outside the top 15 or 20 in the final coaches poll. As you, again, you see just an absolute crack of a goal from Jonathan Raymond. Nothing that hit pass could do about that one. As a goalkeeper, I know what he's feeling. He got a touch on it. Anytime you touch the ball, you think you should have saved it, but nobody was stopping that. But again, none of these teams outside the top 20 in the final coaches poll, so they were all quality teams. But if anybody could be considered a Cinderella coming into this one, it would be Martin Methodist. They come in as the 16 seed. As you see there, the head coach, Coach Cleary, getting the Gatorade bath. They knock off the number one seed, Grandview. They come into the next one, and they run through number one, Grandview. Number eight seed, Bellhaven. Number four, Ashford. And then here they defeat the number 11 seed, Auburn Montgomery Warhawks. It took their first penalty kick win last night, their first penalty kick win since the 08 SSAC championship. But the Red Hawks are national champions.
And you saw there Stephen Lunny coming into the celebration late, and the reason that was, I've got to point out that fantastic show of sportsmanship from him. Came all the way from the goal. He saw all these players down for AUM, and he went over to each of them individually and told them, great game, and shook their hands even though they're on the ground. Some words of encouragement from him, and he has been absolutely class this entire national championship. And just goes to show you great character as well as a great player.
And I could actually see on one of our camera shots, he went all the way down and talked to hit pass. Oftentimes goalkeepers, they're referred to as a different breed, and to a certain extent they are, but it's almost a fraternity. Each one knows what the other one goes through, the mental preparation it takes, the physical toll it takes. You're the last line of defense. Everyone except goalkeepers blames the goalkeeper, saying they could have done something differently. Oftentimes it isn't that simple. But once again, an absolute blistering goal from Jonathan Ramon. We've said he's probably got one of the hardest shots in this tournament. Definitely one of the hardest left feet, if not all together. But again, national champions, Martin Montgomery Redhawks. Just a great ending to this tournament.
And two teams that know each other well played in this one. And again, the SSAC representing in this national championship. Last year, Belhaven winners. This year, another SSAC team. This one actually a new addition. Martin Methodist just came into the conference this year, but doing the SSAC proud. And they're going to be partying tonight, going back to the hotel, and then on the bus ride home. This one won't wash off for another week or two.
And right before they get to the presentation of the James R. Thizer Cup, we want to remind you that Select Super Elite is the official soccer ball of the NAIA. Select Sport America is a proud sponsor of the NAIA Men's and Women's National Soccer Coach of the Year and Player of the Year Awards. NAIA member schools are provided the opportunity to participate in the Select Sport Ball Adoption Program, where a percentage of all the sales of those balls go to the NAIA Champions of Character Program. Please contact your local dealer for more information on the finest hand-sewn soccer balls in the world. Select Sport America, the final official soccer ball of the NAIA. And we want to thank the Bonefish Grill of Montgomery. Bonefish Grill is located at the beautiful shops of East Chase shopping area. Bonefish Grill has the best holiday gift available. When you buy $100 in gift cards, receive an extra $20 bonus card just for yourself. For more information, stop by the Montgomery location or visit them online at bonefishgrill.com. And finally, the Turbo Sports Group is the official video production company of this year's national championship. Don't forget, fans, you can purchase a video download of any game from this year's national championship, and you have an absolute plethora of games to choose from, all with video and audio commentary. Visit TSG online at turbosportsgroup.com.
And I just want to mention this again. I know we mentioned it in the last game and in the pregame leading up to this one. This Martin Methodist team has no seniors on it, so expect them to have a strong team next year as well. They're bringing back all of their stars, all of their starters, and this is a scary team going forward in the future.
And there you see the Auburn-Montgomery Warhawks gathering in their own little circle, getting instruction from Coach Koch. You have to feel for them. They almost seemed like a team of destiny. There were so many games where they were overmatched, outplayed, but in the end they found a way. They had so many last-second goals, overtime winners, literally a last-second goal last night to tie it up, and then a thrilling finish to it where they slipped it past Nomura off the post, collected the rebound, sent them to the championship. Unfortunately for them, their fourth trip to the finals, and still no championships for the Warhawks.
Yeah, disappointing for them, but they played great. Everybody on that team gave it their all, and unlucky not to have their star player Holthus out there on the field.
And now we will step aside and let the PA announcer announce the awards for the second place Auburn-Montgomery Warhawks, and following that, they will have the presentation of medals and the James R. Thizer Cup to the Martin Methodist Redhawks.
Number one, Vigner Johannesson. Number 3, Ayo Ayobson. Number 4, Zach Scott. Number 5, Tim Kaiser. Number 6, Nicholas Hunold. Number 8, Sebastian Vladico. Number 9, Cesar Kestring. Number 10, Christian Holthaus. Number 11, Elvar Sigurdsson. Number 12, Alan Harwell. Number 13, Brandon Perez. Number 14, Philip Zillis. Number 15, Zach Chenthongfio. Number 16, Mattis Kroger. Number 17, Daniel Grobelny. Number 19, Alexander Neubart. Number 20, Grant Dukes. Number 21, Yannick Follick. Number 23, Dagger Janssen. Number 24, Vitor Silva. Head coach, Wolf Koch. Grad assistant, Michael Doherty. Grad assistant, Elvar Goodjohnson. And your honorary coach for AUM, Nathan McMullen. Would coach Wolf Koch and the captains from the AUM Warhawks please step forward and receive the second place trophy? The Nels Dahlquist Memorial Sportsmanship Award, as voted upon by the national championship officials, is given to Ashford for displaying the best sportsmanship at the national championship. Now, to recognize the outstanding individual performances of the 2013 NAIA Championships, we present awards to the all-tournament team as selected by the participating coaches. Starting with the keepers, from Martin Methodist College, Stephen Looney. From AUM, Philip
Hit pass. Now the defenders from AUM. Sebastian Vladico. From Mark Methodist College, Daniel Dunleavy. From Lindsey Wilson, Eric Berthagen. And from Ashford, Mark Hiller. Now the midfielders. From Lindsey Wilson, Elijah Yukpong. From AUM, Elvar Sigurdsson. From Oklahoma Wesleyan, Lucas Almeida. And from Martin Methodist College, Jonathan Raymond. Now the forwards. From Ashford, Daniel Dreyer. From Martin Methodist College, Sean Dong. From AUM, Cesar Kestring. And from Martin Methodist College, Michael Fulton. Ladies and gentlemen, please congratulate the 2013 NAIA All-Tournament Team. And now we present the NAIA Outstanding Offensive and Defensive Player Awards, recognizing the top offensive and defensive performances in this tournament. The 2013 NAIA Outstanding Offensive Player Award goes to Sean Dome from Martin Methodist College. And the 2013 NAIA Most Outstanding Defensive Player Award goes to Stephen Looney from Martin Methodist College. And now, the NAIA Most Valuable Player Award is presented to recognize the top overall performer in this tournament. The 2013 NAIA Men's Soccer Most Valuable Player is Stephen Looney from Martin Methodist College. And now we proudly present individual awards to the 2013 national champions, the Martin Methodist College Redhawks. Number one, Stephen Looney. Number two, Daniel Dunleavy. Number three, Gilbert Monnier. Number four, Spencer England. Number five, Christian Quiñones. Number six, Ryan Hooper. Number seven, Felix Christofferson. Number eight,
Jonathan Raymond. Number 9, Michael Fulton. Number 10, Sean Dong. Number 11, Kenneth Monhay. Number 12, Nicholas Romero. Number 13, Luca Shimoniki. Number 14, Juan Madrigal. Number 16, Darian Tashira. Number 17, Frank Hatangimana. Number 18, Shane Powell. Number 19, Nick Durbin. Number 20, Mamadou Dia. Number 22, Louise Martins. Number 23, Donovan Eubank. Number 24, Duncan Black. Number 32, Sho Ikuta. Assistant head coach, Chris Leonardi. Head coach, Jerry Cleary. Volunteer assistant, Craig Stoltz. Student assistant, Adrian Rafferty. Student assistant, Jack McCarran. And student assistant, Stephen Coughlin. Commissioner Hall will now present the NAIA National Championship Trophy with head coach Jerry Cleary and the captains of the Martin Methodist Redhawks. Please come forward to receive the National Championship Trophy. This year's National Men's Soccer Championship team will be awarded the James R. Thizer Cup. The cup is named for Jim Thizer, the former men's soccer coach at Castleton State University. Jim served as the president of the NAIA Men's Soccer Coaches Association and as the president of the National Soccer Coaches Association of America. Jim is a member of the NAIA Hall of Fame and was selected as the head coach of the Senior Bowl. This award is to honor Jim's memory and his contributions to not only soccer, but the entire NAIA. The Thizer Cup is a traveling trophy passed on each year to the winning NAIA Men's Soccer Team. All the previous 54 team champions are engraved on the cup, and the Martin Methodist College Redhawks will be the 55th team engraved on the cup. And finally, the presentation of the coveted National Championship banner. Would head coach Jerry Cleary and the captains of Martin Methodist College please come forward to receive the National Championship banner. Ladies and gentlemen, the NAIA is proud to recognize the 2013 national champions, the Martin Methodist Redhawks. On behalf of the NAIA, the City of Montgomery, the Central Alabama Sports Commission, the Southern States Athletic Conference, and the Montgomery YMCA, thank you for attending the 55th annual Men's Soccer National Championship Game. Have a safe journey home and a happy holiday season.
And I'm joined right outside the field by Coach Jerry Cleary. Coach Cleary, cold weather out. Your team didn't cool off at all, though. 13-game winning streak now in a national championship. How do you feel after this win?
It's unbelievable, but it's unbelievable. It's going to take a few days to sink in. There's so much emotion in the game. AUM are so good. I just feel like someone burst a bubble or something. I'm just like, but yeah, it's going to take a few days.
Your best player stepped up at the exact right moment. Sean Dong, Jonathan Raymond, and then your keeper, Stephen Lunny. What can you say about these guys? They played so great.
Yeah, but it's everybody. We have two local lads from Nashville, freshman, sophomore, playing center back, Shane Powell and Nick Durbin, and they've been unbelievable all season, and everybody else as a group. It's just a great, great team, and they deserve to be national championships. They worked to get here, so it wasn't given to them.
Yeah, you mentioned the freshmen in the back and the rest of your team also young. No seniors on this team. So you guys think you're going to be back next year?
We hope so. We hope to build a program. We asked this team to build a program, and part of being a program is winning championships. So we just got to keep coming. We're building a tradition. We're building a program. We'll see where we are next year, but we'll enjoy this for a while, and then we'll see.
Yeah, your players are going to have a fun bus ride on the way back to Martin Methodist in Tennessee. And just congratulations to you guys again, and congratulations to you, Coach, on your third title, first in men's.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Coach. All right, and as we await word from Jonathan Raymond and a few other players that we might try and interview, I'll send it back up into the booth with Todd Panula.
And once again, the final here, Martin Methodist. There's a lot of M's here. Martin Methodist defeats Auburn Montgomery in overtime, 2-1. And as Josh set it up for me right there, Jonathan Raymond, the player of the game, he with the absolute crack of a goal, cracker of a shot from about, I'd say about 25 yards out, just a blistering left foot and hit pass, had absolutely no chance to stop that one. We'll recap the scoring for you here as we try to get the interview. Once again, the initial goal coming from Sean Dong in the 14th minute. The equalizer goal came at the 64th minute from Mathis Kruger, the hero from last night. He was the hero again tonight for Auburn Montgomery, but it was not to be their evening as Jonathan Raymond with that 97th minute strike. Just an absolute blistering shot. And now we will send it back down to Josh, who has our man of the tournament, Sean Dong.
And again, Josh Brown joining the man of the hour for this Martin Methodist team, Sean Dong. You've been a superstar in this national championship. Where did the confidence come from? A hat trick to start things off against Grandview? And it's just kept coming, man.
I don't know where it's coming from, but I'm really glad that we won. You know, I wouldn't take it as individual. I think our team worked really hard, and I think it's all our team, like my teammates. I'm really pleasured to play with them, and yeah, I'm really happy to win this.
That first goal, and then from you, and then the second goal from Raymond were absolutely brilliant from both of you. And when you saw Raymond set up on the top of the box, did you know it was going in?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. He has great left footer. I believe in him all the time, and he's my great mate. I really believe in him. I believe everyone. It's amazing. It's really good.
A great team effort from you guys, and be honest with me now. You guys think you're going to be back next year?
Yeah, definitely. We'll be back.
I love it. Sean Dong. MVP Sean Dong. You see him get mobbed here by the crowd of Martin Methodist players. Sean, thanks for joining me. Great tournament.
Thank you so much.
And I'll send it back up to Todd.
And thanks, Josh. Great work down there. Great work by everybody on this team. As we wrap things up for you here, once again, the national champions for the NAIA in terms of men's soccer, the Martin Methodist Redhawks 2013 National Championships. And what a tournament. We just want to run down for you quickly here if we can. If I can even find my sheet, as to how the path that Martin Methodist took to the championship here. They started things off in the opening round against Brian from Tennessee. They won that one 2-0, so they actually had two clean sheets in this one. The next one would come against the number one seed, Grandview from Iowa. That one a 5-0 victory, their first here at the final site, and things just sprinted off from there as Martin would defeat Bellhaven 3-2. That would end a 311-minute shutout streak. Martin would defeat Ashford. They tied in regulation 1-1. They won 5-4 on penalty kicks, an absolute heartbreaker for Ashford, but Martin would continue on. They would face the team seemingly of destiny, the team that would not give up, Auburn Montgomery, in the finals. But again, it was not to be the Warhawks' night, as the Red Hawks are national championships, or national champions, 2-1. And I'm joined once again by Josh Brown. Final thoughts, Josh. What a tournament we've seen here.
After a brisk jog up here, I'm happy to be back in the booth with you. And just a fantastic national championship. You could not ask for anything more. Goals galore from everybody. Overtimes, penalty kicks. This has been absolutely fantastic. And don't expect it to be any different next year. All these teams bring back quality players. And this team especially, Martin Methodist, you heard the confidence and humility both from Sean Dong. He said he believes in his team as a whole, but he believes they'll be back next year. And they've been a pleasure to watch. Just hats off to them. And I just want to thank everybody who's helped us out up here. So many people behind the scenes who you will never see, even if you're at the site up here in the booth helping us out. Just thanks to all of them. And thanks to our production staff, Justin Cook, Eric Alberon, Andreas Palacio, Matt Mahoney, and Scott Newsom. Just fantastic job, you guys. And I've just had a great opportunity to do this with you and be up here in the booth with you, Todd.
And as we say our final goodbyes, I want to thank you, Josh. You did a great job all tournament, as did everybody. And you pretty much stole everything that I want to say, but I'll go ahead and repeat your final words.
Just redo it.
We want to thank all the SIDs here. They fed us so much great information, made us look smart, even though we constantly were getting notes from that. We want to thank all the staff here at the Southern States Athletic Conference and the NAIA for their help in providing food here. Sam Neans, he did a great job. He's one of the interns here. We got a lot of great information from here, from him. The great staff at the Emory Fulmer YMCA complex. They had great fields, a great facility. It was nice up here in the press box. Just an outstanding job by them. They were really impressed with the varying forms of weather that we got. And again, our fantastic cameraman who braved the elements and got great shots, Justin Cook, Andres Palacio, Eric Albron, and we want to thank Scott Cheney. He showed up early. He stayed late. He lugged equipment. He pretty much did it all with no thanks, but we want to thank him for getting us the opportunity to get these shots out there to you. Matt Mahoney, he's a great broadcaster. He helped out in producing. Josh Brown, once again, top-notch commentary. And I'd also like to send a personal thanks out to executive producer and Turbo Sports president Chase Needing for the opportunity to let us all come here and bring you this absolutely fantastic tournament. So we are going to say goodbye for this evening. Once again, the final in overtime, Martin Methodist defeats Auburn Montgomery by the score of 2-1. We hope you enjoyed the soccer we brought to you here. It was of the highest quality. And until next time, I'm Todd Panula. Good night, everybody.
There's a call to be answered. The spirit of competition is still alive inside. The desire still drives. The phrase student athlete has a great ring to it. Lasting friendships are ready to be made. You just want to keep playing. Game on. Get in the game at playnaia.org.
Tra la la tra la tra la
Blender.
Every Italian family has their own treasured recipes. And now at Carrabba's, we're serving up two family favorites on one plate. Like our wood-grilled sirloin, topped with handmade marsala sauce and served alongside our signature chicken Brian ravioli. Or enjoy fresh ingredients and layers of flavor, all grilled over a wood fire with our Polo Rosa Maria and chicken involtini. Some of our best recipes are together at last, but only for a short time. So find your favorite tonight and come home to Carrabba's.
I had a dream, a beautiful dream. I couldn't believe how real it seemed. Up on stage, in a field of green, on the winding river, when I saw you sing, when I wake up.